And welcome to the fourth meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind those committee members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is to decide whether to take item 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Agenda item 2 is the Good Food Nation Bill Scotland, we're continuing our evidence sessions on the bill, and I welcome to the meeting our first panel, who will focus on policy outcomes relating to environment and sustainability. With us today, we've got Ian Gullen, the Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer from Zero Waste Scotland, Mike Rivington, a Land Use Systems Modeller from the James Hutton Institute, Dr. Christine Shields, lecturer in International Law and Food Security, Global Academy of Agriculture and Food Security, and Vicky Swales, Head of Land Use Policy, RSPB Scotland, and here representing Scottish Environmental Link. So we'll move to questions. We'd have about 90 minutes of questions, and I'll kick off. excuse me. What I'd like to hear is your experiences of the food systems and issues within that system facing Scotland with regard to the environment, waste and related issues. I'm going to go to each of the panel, but I would like if Dr. Rivington would also expand on the experiences throughout the pandemic and how this might help inform our approach to food policies in the event of further environmental shocks. So we'll start off with Ian Gullen, please.
Okay, thank you, convener. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. So certainly we, Zero Waste Scotland, we welcome the introduction of the Good Food Nation Bill and its commitment to addressing not just the environmental aspects of the food system, but doing so in equal importance to the social, health and economic pillars as well. So also our focus is on food waste and the impact of that. So I think it's clear to say that the impact of our food systems in tackling the climate emergency has been severely understated to date. Topics like energy, transport and plastics dominate our conversation quite often about the environment, which was also evident during COP26. But in fact, our consumption of materials and resources is responsible for around 80% of Scotland's carbon footprint, and food makes up a significant part of that. And I think we all know agriculture and associated land use accounts for around a quarter of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions. So we look at the global picture in terms of food loss and waste. If food loss and waste were a country, it would be the third largest carbon footprint in the world after the USA and China. And yet, a staggering one-third of all the food that we produce globally is lost or wasted. So food production doesn't just contribute to climate change, it also is one of the biggest causes of biodiversity loss, as habitats of the natural environment are destroyed to create farmland. In fact, an area larger than China is used to grow food that is never eaten. It's also a moral issue. If we consider the 1 billion hungry people in the world, they could be fed on less than a quarter of the food that is wasted in the UK, USA and Europe put together. In Scotland, unfortunately, we're part of this problem. So collectively in Scotland, we throw away more than 980,000 tonnes of food, so just under a million tonnes of food every year. 40% of that is in our food industries, like manufacturing, retail, hospitality and food services, but over 60% comes from households up and down Scotland. So we all have a role to play, whether we are part of the food industry or not. Hospitality and food services, the equivalent of 106 million meals are discarded every year in Scotland. That's one out of every six meals served, and is a great cost to our hospitality and food service industry. So even if you consider filling a wheelie bin with food waste every week, that's costing a business about £8,000 a year. We also need to grow more food in Scotland to save emissions from imported food and ensure that our food supply chain is more resilient to global shocks such as the pandemic. And you've mentioned that already, convener. At the same time, inedible parts and byproducts from food production should be fed back into the system to grow more food and enable creative new solutions. But ultimately, we all need to support Scottish households across the country to put an end to edible food waste in our homes and to recycle as much as we can what we cannot be eaten to prevent it going to landfill. When we waste food, we also waste the water, energy and resources that went into growing it. The Good Food Nation Bill should be seen as an enabler for this. The inclusion of a food waste indicator and food waste reduction actions in the national, the NHS and the local authority Good Food Nation plans will help us to monitor this progress and allow for smarter targeting of action and support. The bill needs to be a catalyst for a system-wide approach to how we grow, produce, supply and consume our food, that it delivers a more sustainable, healthy and equitable future for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ian. And Dr. Rivington.
Good morning. Thanks very much, Convener. If I just pick up on your first question about the COVID aspect as well, because I think that helps set the context a little bit. Primarily, the COVID impact was a demand-side shock, not a production shock. There were impacts on the production side, but primarily it was a demand side caused by the loss of income. And what we saw really was a sort of a divide in the impact in terms of the demand side, that there were some people who were severely impacted by the COVID pandemic in terms of access to food. And by that, I mean economic access and physical access. But the production side wasn't that impacted, despite actually 2020 having quite a severe sort of combination of the weather events that meant overall production in the UK was lower than average. So what we were trying to glean from the COVID impact was complicated further by Brexit and trying to understand what the impacts of that were. But what the main message from the COVID impact was that there was a need to ensure food security within Scotland to support the most vulnerable people, and that can be best achieved by financial support rather than making food available directly. So really what we found from the COVID impact was that food wasn't in shortage. What was in short supply was access to food, affordable food, because of the economic aspects. And where we can then connect that through looking forward to the Good Food Nation Bill and what it's trying to achieve in terms of how it's handling climate change impacts and biodiversity loss and ecosystem degradation impacts on food, is that is likely to be a production side shock. So the two things are a little bit difficult to compare, because what we're talking about in terms of future risks are primarily production side shocks. And I think it's really important to flag that the UK as a whole imports about 48% of its food, so therefore we have to consider the impacts internationally of all of these different drivers that are likely to produce production shocks. We can't look at Scotland in isolation. And I think Ian just made very good points about the scale at which the international aspect is a key role in this, and the fact that we waste so much food, or so much food is lost, and that is likely to increase with climate change impact. So I think it's really important when we're looking at the Food Nation Bill is how we consider the international context as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. Shields, please.
Hello, and thanks for having me. My research is in law and governance in relation to land and food. In response to your question about observations and as a result of COVID and so forth, I'd say the key one is that we can't rely on changes at household levels. If we want people to have healthy, sustainable diets, we have to have healthy, sustainable sources of food. And a good place to start is with public institutions, schools, hospitals, etc. And we need to increase access to sustainable food sources, and that and access, we need to look at access in different ways and understand the real obstacles to access. I'd also like to make a few comments on the scope and ambition of the bill. The bill focuses on process and duties on relevant authorities to create food plans, and that is exciting from a democratic perspective. And it's helpful to have those bodies on board and for partnership, but it cannot be assumed that this will create an equality of impacts or food systems transitions. And we need to ensure that the Good Food Nation Bill engages with the whole food system, from production to consumption, from farm to fork. And in particular, there's an opportunity here to close the gap between farm and fork. By that, I mean cultivate closer relationships with farms and food producers through local suppliers of food. And there's an opportunity to do something innovative in relation to the land diets nexus. For example, despite being the UK's largest local authority by landmass, the Highland region produces very little fruit.
Oh, I'm afraid it looks like we've lost Dr. Shields at the moment. Can we try and Vicky Swales, can I ask you to come in at this point until we get Dr. Shields back? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to members of the committee. If I pick up on Scottish Environment Link's understanding of the environmental impacts of our food system, as previous speakers have indicated, we know that our food system has very significant environmental footprint, affecting biodiversity and our climate globally and domestically, on land and at sea as well. So in the face of a nature and climate emergency, it's really critical that we look at our food system and we look at reducing the environmental impacts of that food system. And it's really critical from our perspective that we take action now and we take it quickly. This decade is really significant to 2030. It's the UN decade of ecosystem restoration. We know we're going to have legally binding targets for nature recovery, and we have to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 75% by 2030 if we're going to get to net zero by 2045. And we have a clear and growing evidence base, I think, about the state of our environment and some of the drivers behind that. We've had some big international assessments, biodiversity. We have the Biodiversity Intactness Index of how much human activity has impacted on nature. And of 240 countries, Scotland is 28th from the bottom. So we're not doing very well in terms of what's happening to biodiversity. And our State of Nature report has summarised very clearly the problems facing very many species. We've had 49% decline of species in abundance, 11% of species threatened with extinction. And as other speakers have highlighted, we have very significant greenhouse gas emissions from land use, from farming, from our food system as a whole. And we've really got to tackle those issues, and we need to transition quickly to farming and fishing methods that are nature and climate friendly, which reduce those emissions, which reduce those impacts on biodiversity. And our food system has a really big part to play in that. It's part of the problem currently, but it needs to be part of the solution too. And Bill is really being in a position to help drive forward change and some of the transformational change that we're going to need to do that quite quickly in this next decade.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move back to Dr. Shields, but I'm going to ask my next question. We've heard that the plan, the bill needs to do this and it needs to do that. But Dr. Shields, you said we shouldn't assume that it's just going to do that. Now, the bill as drafted in front of us is really a framework bill, so it doesn't, as it sits, potentially achieve any of the ambitions that stakeholders would like it to. So there's maybe an argument that the bill shouldn't have been laid in the way it has been now, and the government should have fleshed it out a little bit more. It looks like at the moment that it's going to be left to parliamentarians to bring forward amendments to deliver some of those ambitions. So can I ask you, and I'll start with Dr. Shields, is that your understanding? Do you think that the bill as drafted is going to enable Scotland to achieve its ambitions?
There's a lot that needs to be added to the bill. Beyond a general mission statement, there needs to be reporting procedures and accountability mechanisms and a clear definition of what we mean by good food. There's also opportunity to expand the commitments under Section 3. And as this session is on the environment, there's scope to add links to key frameworks around the environment, for instance, FAO and WHO's guidelines on sustainable healthy diets. Some of those principles are around use of pathogens and toxins and maintaining greenhouse gas emissions, preserving biodiversity, minimising the use of antibiotics, reducing food loss and waste, and so forth. So there's a lot more that could be done to hitch this to international frameworks. There's also the right to a healthy and sustainable environment, which was passed in a resolution on the 8th of October 2021, which is highly relevant for this bill. And there's also options like what France has done recently. It passed a law in 2008, which came into force in January 2022, that demands that 50% of sustainable products are used in public institutions catering. And it includes measures against food waste and bans on food surpluses and things like this. So there can be a level of specificity, and there can also be attachment to the broader framework issues. And I certainly look forward to that being built into the bill, as you say, through discussion and amendments.
Thank you. A brief supplementary from Rachel Hamilton and then Alistair Allen.
On the point you've just made there, Kirsteen, do you believe that the Good Food Nation Bill is the place to strengthen the procurement rules in Scotland?
Absolutely, absolutely. Without stronger procurement rules, what are we dealing with? So procurement rules enable us to build closer connections over the source of our food supply. And by doing that, we can regenerate food production across Scotland by specifying particular quality of produce in procurement. So I think procurement is really where the magic happens.
Thank you. What I'm going to do, I'll go to the other panel members before bringing Alistair in, if you don't mind. So, Ian, what's your views on the drafted bill as before us at the moment?
Yeah, I agree to some extent. If the bill was more prescriptive and had more specific actions contained in it as presented, and specific targets, obviously, you could see a benefit from that. But there's also, obviously, it's enabling legislation. So I think the power is how the plans that are developed by both the government and local authorities, probably local authorities in particular, how they could actually really shape the future that we're talking about. I think the power that they have, not just in writing a plan and looking about their own internal operations, how they could strengthen and work together collaboratively, all 32 local authorities, for instance, all national health boards work together to really shape that new food system that we're all talking about, more sustainable, more healthy, more accessible in terms of population and diet, etc. And I think that's something I certainly witnessed during Glasgow COP26, was almost an awakening of cities, particularly, presented in a number of events, around this agenda. How cities, where they don't, they import, almost 99% of all the food that goes into cities all comes from out with cities. The influence that they could have, both individually, but more importantly, working together, collaboratively together across, and comes back to that point about procurement. So That's I think that's where the ambition needs to lie. If we're really serious about that, how could the public bodies come together, not just trying to address their own particular issues, and absolutely they need to do that, you know, in terms of the populations they serve, but how could they come together and really shape that system, both at a national level but also collaborative across all parts of Scotland? I think that's, you know, having that ambition set out, and how do we support them? So how do agencies like myself support all of those plans, so they're all aligned, they're all joined up, they're all in the same direction, and those real significant opportunities, you know, so it's not a fragmented approach, it's a joined up approach across Scotland, I believe, could deliver. If that ambition is set out in the plans and it's taken forward by particularly local authorities, I think, and the other agencies, then I think we would see the success that we're all aspiring to.
Thank you. And Dr. Rivington, do you think that the bill is drafted in front of us is going to be fit for purpose? Are we assuming too much and what's in front of us?
I think there's good scope for additional ambition. What I would say, I think there's a time imperative here in that we are desperate to meet the 1.5 degree target, and therefore actions need to be taken as soon as possible. And I appreciate it takes quite a long time to get a bill through Parliament. So there is an imperative to try and set things in motion, and also understanding that bills can be amended afterwards. So I think it would be really important to get things moving as fast as possible. And I think at this point, I'd like to sort of bring in just a sort of a notion about the psychology of the population in terms of what we have with the food bill is the Good Food Nation bill is an opportunity to bring everybody on board to take steps towards mitigating climate change through our choices of the food that we consume and where we buy it from. So I think that there's room for ambition within it, but I think if the delay of waiting until you've got something which is more ideal as a bill may miss that sort of window of opportunity that may fade in the coming sort of year or two in terms of that sort of immediate response to the climate emergency. And I think we've already witnessed that to some extent after COP26. There was obviously a lot of interest, but other things that distract us in the news and things take away the thought about the sort of climate and biodiversity crisis. So I think what I would urge is that, you know, not to wait until the bill is perfect, but rather to get it through on the basis that what you can do is use it as impetus to try and get everybody on board, the whole population on board, as to the scale of the emergency and what the individuals can do about it. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to Alistair Allen, who's got some supplementaries.
Thank you very much, Convener. Question for Ian Gulland. It was really about some of the fearful statistics you've just given us about food waste and the solution that you're setting out, which quite rightly you're advocating for more food to be grown in Scotland that can be used in Scotland. It was really just to ask you about how this all relates to the problem that we were talking about last week, which is the affordability of food, not just because of the cost of living going up, but more generally, you know, we've been talking through this issue of how do we make food affordable for people on low income. So I just wonder if you can say something about how this thing we want to see, all want to see happen, more food grown in Scotland, being used in Scotland as a solution to some of the problems you've outlined, how we actually make that happen in terms of affordability.
Good question. I mean, obviously, there's the aspect of, you know, the price of food, but also the fact that, you know, across all parts of society, you know, we waste food, and that's a cost. You know, we talked about the carbon emissions, but, you know, for the average household, it's about, I think it ranges from around about £500 a year that we're spending on food that we don't eat. So that's another aspect to this as well, not just the price of food that, you know, that basically is impacting on our, you know, our households and the affordable money that we've got to spend. If we could just think differently about how we buy food, how we consume it, how we store it, you know, because there's elements of clearly aspects of behaviours that we could support at household level, so people, you know, in terms of cooking, preparing food, so they don't waste food, they store food, you know, properly, whether it's in the fridge or the freezer. use leftovers, etc., to save money. So that allows them to, you know, to some extent, spend the money on food going forward. There's also aspects, I think, again, about how do we grow more food in, you know, again, for all the businesses I've talked about, you know, that we work with directly, you know, they are making cost savings. So food waste within, whether it's the production, whether it's the supply or the retail, the food waste costs them money. So therefore, that's a cost that they're having to put on to the price of food or the price of their operation. So again, by addressing the food waste issue, not only is obviously good for the climate, it's good for the, you know, it's good for the economy. That almost million tons of food that we waste throughout the supply chain is over £1 billion of cost to the economy, you know, both at household level and within industry. I mean, I think the hospitality industry, it costs them about £170 million a year, and particularly now when the hospitality industry is under such pressure, you know, that's the waste. That is what's impacting on their bottom line. So whilst there's obviously more challenges about making the cost of food, you know, or looking at the cost of food, you know, the savings that can be made right through it. And obviously, if we start to onshore some of that production and some of that growing here in Scotland, there's huge potential for us to reduce those costs even further by thinking about the whole supply system and the inputs into that, particularly around, you know, inorganic fertilisers, etc., and thinking differently about how we grow our food in Scotland and addressing that. So. And going back to the point about how local authorities could influence this, you know, by working collaboratively together to create innovative solutions to how food is grown and prepared and supplied. You know, with one of the big things I'm sure other people saw during COP26 was vertical farming. It was promoted by a Scottish-based company, IGS. Innovative Growth Solutions looked at that. And, you know, as a real opportunity to grow more food more sustainably here in Scotland, obviously not replacing a whole market of food, but specific food types and providing that at local level, at reduced cost, reduced environmental impact, less transport to, you know, people across the whole of Scotland. What an opportunity for us. And that could be, that innovation could be supported by the likes of local authorities and NHS and other partners working together to create the market pool for those reduced cost solutions.
Thank you. And can I bring in Vicky Swales and then Dr. Shields, please?
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to come back, if I may, to your question of whether the bill as drafted will help us achieve its ambitions. And you said that it should be a framework law. Environment Link perspective, we feel that the bill as drafted is very light in ambition and content. It's a good start. We need a national food plan. We need local food plans, absolutely. But the bill as drafted doesn't establish a very clear purpose around what we mean around a good food nation, high-level principles, or give us that sense of direction of travel in Scotland that we need, and clear goals for our food system and a process for delivering and reporting on progress, for example. So those principles and goals which should be set out on the face of the bill would then need to underpin and inform national plans, local food plans, and indeed future relevant legislation, regulation and policy. So, for example, we know we're going to have an agriculture bill, a natural environment bill, we've got the national planning framework for going through at the moment. So we very much like to see clear purpose on the face of the bill. We think the bill should establish some high-level targets which would help drive progress and things we can measure against. We also think there needs to be the establishment, we may come onto this, of a body, an independent body, a statutory food commission, which would help to provide coherence and oversight, look at how we monitor and evaluate progress in our food system in order to deliver all the things that we need, whether that's thinking about health or environment, the affordability of food, access to food, everything else, all these really difficult issues that face our food system.
And Dr. Shields.
Thank you. In response to Alistair Allen, MSP's question about the cost of a transition, just to say that cheap food is actually extremely expensive when we consider the impacts on the environment and especially on health and on NCDs. So perhaps the most critical thing that the bill has to build in is a budget sharing mechanism where it can move towards looking at net budget savings and start to long-term funding for a food system which will offset costs in other parts of government.
Thank you very much. I've got a short supplementary from Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. This question is specifically to Ian Gullen. Ian, are you suggesting that all local authorities should work to the same plan collaboratively and effectively have one national local plan, if that makes sense?
Yeah, not quite. I mean, I think they all have to. I mean, they'll all have specific, almost internal issues within their local authority area to address in terms of accessibility to food. I get that, but I think that to me, the power of the bill is not just them thinking absolutely about addressing food issues within their local authority, but how they could influence the food supply chain, you know, and in terms of economic development, in terms of the wider food system. So I think that, you know, for things like creating a market pool for things like vertical farming or, you know, enhanced innovation in food supply through the agricultural system, thinking about, you know, that probably, I think, needs collective action, needs, you know, instead of a kind of fragmented approach. I mean, there's lots of great stuff happening. Replicating those ideas across different local authorities, I think, still happens. But I think the power of the bill would be how those different parts could really mobilise together and think beyond, you know, their own local authority area and how they could shape the supply chains both here in Scotland and abroad to push further, certainly from the climate point of view, and possibly, you know, create more economic prosperity for Scotland in the agriculture and food service. So it's about, but how do we make sure that all the individual plans are not just are aligned if they're all going to go and do that type of work. So they're all, you know, there's potential identification of those opportunities at a national level, and then the local authorities can see how they can play into those. So we don't, you know, to some extent, we try and create the biggest impacts of a small number of interventions at a national level to create the impact that we're all talking about.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, questions from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Really interesting what you had to say, Ian, in terms of collaborative working and that coming together with purpose and sustainable goals. I've been asking, you know, the panel really about targets the last few weeks, and what I've realised is, you know, that stakeholders have very specific targets, very specific asks, and oftentimes they don't cross over with other stakeholders' ambitions. And so to that extent, can targets be too constraining on achieving ultimate ambitions of a good food nation? And also, could it perhaps constrain local diversity approaches bespoke to their own specific areas, as Jim touched upon as well? So how does the panel see a more collaborative and collective plan for food in Scotland, which is important and what Ian kind of touched upon, but that would also ensure effective action, you know, making that connection with sustainable development goals, as opposed to targets which perhaps could be more of a problem than part of a whole culture change? Open that up to Ian first. Is that okay?
Yeah. I'm a great believer in target setting, the framework for action, and, you know, almost we have a national target for food waste reduction from the Scottish Government, 33% by 2025. There's a UN target of 50% reduction by 2030. So those are the kind of, that's the ambition. But I do think it's up to whether it's different sectors or different parts of Scotland to understand how do they then contribute to that. And set their own goals, whether they, you know, set the specific same target. But I think the key for me is the collaborative nature, is how do we, you know, because of the time frame that we're all working in now in terms of climate change and the necessity to scale up, we need to work together. And I'm not, you know, there's lots of initiatives, lots of successful initiatives on food waste happening at a local level, but they're small, they're targeted, yes, they're ambitious, yes, they're delivering, but we need to scale some of those up. So how do we ensure that whether it's local authorities or different agencies, NHS or otherwise, working together to share best practice, share the learning, share the successes, and how can we then replicate those across, so instead of trying to reinvent different programmes and projects. I think that's the key. So it's about how do we create that collaboration and synergy, you know, where there's really big opportunities, both in terms of supply and land management and, you know, particular dietary issues that we need to address that we could do together. And so whether that's around a common target or a common activity or a common, you know, understanding of the challenges and how they can shape some of those opportunities, I think that, for me, that's the power of the bill, is how do we bring everybody together around a common purpose that everybody recognises, rather than, you're right, divide up the target amongst everybody, and then it becomes everybody then just focus on their bit of it, because this is a systems approach. I mean, I think everybody said that. You can't look at this in isolation. Everything is connected. And if we're serious about doing it, we all have to be at the table working on this together.
And Vicky Swales, would like to come on this?
Thanks very much. I mean, I absolutely agree with that. It really is a systems approach, but also with the fact that we would like to see some headline outcome targets on the face of the bill. I think they're really important in terms of setting the direction of travel, in terms of driving outcomes, in terms of giving clarity to everyone about what we're trying to achieve. From an environmental perspective, we think we could include an environmental target to halve the environmental impact of the food system, including food waste, by 2030. So that's picking up on what Ian's just said about going further than the current targets on food waste, for example. Because what targets do require us to measure and establish baselines and work out what's possible and to look at the impacts of the food system. And then we can identify the appropriate indicators and the metrics by which we do that and really judge whether we're making progress towards those outcomes that we're all looking for or not. So I think that's really important. But clearly how we do that and how we achieve those targets requires everybody to play their part. It requires a lot of collaborative action, a lot of collaborative working. So I think the process of producing the national food plans, producing those local food plans, is going to require the engagement of a wide range of stakeholders and individuals and actors. And that perhaps brings to a point we may come on to about participation and how we engage people in the processes of working out what it is we need to be doing and how we deliver against the goals that we're setting up for ourselves, and therefore how we genuinely do create a good food nation. Which is tackling environmental issues, health issues, food waste, all those things that we know about, food inequalities, et cetera.
Thank you. And Dr. Shields.
Thank you. I agree that targets are problematic and the relevant authorities are going to face hard choices between competing priorities. And with the targets as well, there's certain gaps in our indicators, and there's the issue of what isn't counted, isn't measured, and therefore isn't valued. So targets are problematic. If there are targets included, I would also say that there has to be a statement to say that there's a responsibility on government to assist the relevant authorities in achieving the targets. Just asking the relevant authorities to meet the targets is going to create very diverse outcomes. But there should be, in order to connect the plans, there should be an overarching national food strategy and mission statement. That strategy should focus on reorientating food systems to link health and environment, and the economy will fit in to that. And there's a number of ways of reorientating, realigning food and health and environment through food, for example, increasing production of local fruit and veg. There also has to be, with the targets or with any mission statements, there also has to be a platform to share common resources between the authorities, to share experience and evidence and decision support tools. And this platform should also put data within reach of different authorities. Otherwise, we are going to have huge disparities between areas. And there's lots of models as to how to do that. For instance, the Scottish Centres of Expertise have teams who are, you know, neutral and can provide support to targeted issues. So, yeah.
Thank you. And Dr. Rivington.
Thank you, Convener. I think the issue of having targets is going to be a little bit central to this. I mean, you can argue that without the climate change, targets activities really wouldn't have happened. And so if we have targets, then we have something to aim for. Now, if you go with the argument that we become what we measure, and we develop appropriate monitoring, reporting and verification of those targets, then they can actually become quite a useful tool. But I take Kirstine's point that there will be gaps in between, but there are some targets that could be linked to other objectives. For example, soil health. You have a soil health indicator. If the soil health indicator is improving, then I think it can relate through to the sort of quality of food and the ability to provide it in the long term. So there are a range of targets which can be set for other purposes as well. But I think it would be really important to include things that are sort of perhaps seen as beyond the food system, which are actually really quite essential parts of it as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And move on to a question from Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Convener. I was really interested in Ian's position regarding the collaboration across the local authorities and government. And my understanding of this bill is it's an enabling bill that will allow us to create a shift in the culture of how we use food and what food is and how people feel about their food. And following on from the progress that we've already made, because we've made huge strides in Scotland over the years to improve the food quality over the last 20 years, certainly. But there's always a wee dichotomy for me, and that's how the coherence between the Good Food Nation Bill and other upcoming legislation and policy changes, like the Agricultural Bill, Circular Economy Bill, Natural Environment Bill, even the Human Rights Bill. How do we get those things connected so that they're working in tandem? And Ian, I'll come to you first. Sorry.
Yeah, that's quite a challenging question to some extent, because there's a lot of these bills and initiatives, and I think that's the challenge of our time. Is, you know, we've certainly seen how climate change isn't any a particular silo can sort this out. You know, it's all aspects of society and industry, and everything's interconnected, even from ourselves, our own decisions, and the power of national governments and local governments and communities to make the change. We all have to be aligned. So I think, yeah, I think there's an opportunity here in Scotland, because we, you know, we have the ambition, obviously, around climate change, around tackling poverty and all the other aspects that we want to address, to work more collaboratively. And to some extent, it's creating a different platform for us all to you know, to speak about this, to work, to contribute, not to see food as, you know, in a particular part of society or even within the parliament. I mean, it's interesting, you know, depends on, you know, talking to a different committee for me to talk about food waste, where I usually would talk to the, you know, the net zero committee about this. So how do we get everybody to see that this is so important and a priority? And food, I think, you know, you could argue that food is possibly the most important thing for all of us in terms of sustainability. So maybe that trumps all the other things to an extent, that if we can get food right and the way that we grow our food, the way we distribute our food, the way we use our land to do that, you know, we can solve some of these other aspects of agriculture or the natural environment, etc., because of the impact that the current food system is having on a biodiversity loss and land use and all the things that we've just talked about. So it's how do we almost prioritise? What is the priority in all of those bills? Is it food and the way that we produce food, use our land to produce food and ultimately supply it? But I think it's, yeah, I mean, it is, I think we're you know, for me, obviously, you know, because of food, I think we need to talk about food waste. In terms of climate ambitions, I think, as I said, it's been understated. It's not something that even, you know, we see even nationally is part of it. When we talk, the narrative around climate change is about flying, about reducing flying, you know, about renewables, etc. All of that is important and we need to do that. But ultimately, how we, you know, the impact of our food system, both here in Scotland and globally, is really the biggest contributor to climate change. And we need to do something about it. So if we're serious at that, out with the recovery from the pandemic and the health crisis that we still currently are in, if climate change is the biggest challenge that we face, not just here in Scotland but globally, then we need to address food waste, and that needs to be our, you know, one of our overarching priorities, you know, in terms of action, and all the other bills and all the other activities that we're involved in need to feed into that.
And maybe on to, maybe views of Dr. Shields on policy coherency.
Yes, I would say that it's tempting always to think of these policies as competing, when in fact they're all mutually reinforcing. A healthy environment is essential for healthy diets. Healthy diets are essential for the economy and for issues of equality and justice. So they are all aiming in the same direction. And I think we should avoid looking at policies as being competing. In fact, it's a circular economy between the gains that are achieved in one area can feed progress in the other area. Against that, I would say then, you know, if there's any doubt as to what the overarching aim should be, it's time to refer to the constitution. It's at that level of, you know, what are the aims? What is the government here to do? What is the highest aim of government? And all these policy statements should be feeding into that.
Thank you. And finally, on that supplementary, Dr. Rivington. Oh no, we've lost him. Vicky Swales, have you got a comment on policy coherency?
Yes, thank you, Convener. As we're establishing food intersects, obviously with so many different areas, and is relevant to some aspects of policy and forthcoming legislation. And I think this comes back to the Good Food Nation Bill having a clear sense of purpose and setting out direction, because and also if we put some clear targets in it, and if we have an overarching body looking at policy coherence. So that's a key link for a statutory food, and that I then inform lots of things that then come down the line. So as Jim mentioned, we know we've got an agriculture bill coming, we have a natural environment bill, circular economy, all these things are relevant, but they can take their lead if there's clarity and a clear sense of direction about how we want to improve our food system in Scotland in the Good Food Nation Bill. Then that will help to create policy coherence and inform other aspects of legislation and other areas of policy that are coming, and in our marine environment as well, for example. And just if I can just pick up on a really key one, I think, in terms of looking at some of the environmental impacts and thinking about that agriculture bill, then we very much see the Good Food Nation Bill has got to lead the way for that agriculture bill, which will create the powers for a new system of farm support. So if we're serious about reducing the environmental impact of our food system, we need to transition to farming systems and practices that are going to help us do that. We're going to tackle the nature and climate emergency. And that means we need to refocus how we spend that £650 million thereabouts of public money that goes into supporting farming to better deliver against some of the outcomes that we're looking for in terms of environment and healthy foods and everything else. So there's various mechanisms that the Good Food Nation Bill can establish, which help to create policy coherence, I think, and give a lead to other areas of policy and legislation.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from Rachel Hamilton.
It was actually just to pick up on the disagreement within the group of evidence today, where some believe that targets are suitable and some believe that they're not. And I know within this room there is disagreement on that as well. Yesterday in the Health Committee, Marie Todd said that there was a really worrying increase in childhood health problems, with 15.5% of primary one children at risk of obesity last year, up from 10% in 2009. And we know, because it was mentioned last week by Karen Adam, that it is a peculiarity of the modern food system that obesity sometimes coexists with hunger. So bad diets per calorie are much cheaper than healthy diets. And I want to open it up to the panel. In your opinion, firstly to Kirstein, without targets on the face of the bill, how can these various environmental issues, dietary issues, be achieved? I really appreciate that you have said that targets are not necessarily something you support, but I think for this committee, it's important to really hone in to know why.
So glad to have the opportunity to clarify that. I agree that targets are difficult and they're problematic. It doesn't mean that we shouldn't use them. If they are on the bill, the responsibility for meeting the targets has to be with government to resource the relevant authorities to work towards the targets, and then the benefits of working towards those targets can be met. So I'm not saying that there shouldn't be targets on the face of the bill or in the bill, but I am agreeing that there are problems with targets, and targets done badly can create more harm. So we have to get the targets right, and that's a lot about the content of the target themselves, but also the accountability towards the targets. And targets without budget are not particularly helpful.
Can I develop my question?
Briefly.
Yeah. To Mike, on the land use strategy itself, how can diet and land use be married up?
I think one of the opportunities is to focus on more locally produced fruit and veg production. Obviously, a large area is put aside for grazing and for livestock, and that land area in itself is now under pressure for carbon sequestration purposes, say, for example, from tree planting. Given that we import so many of our food and vegetables from places which may in the future and near future become more vulnerable to the impacts of climate change and potentially experience water shortages, we have the opportunity in Scotland to be able to produce more of the sort of high nutrition food from fruit and vegetables at home. And as Ian has mentioned, there are also great opportunities from the vertical farming and controlled environment agriculture as well. So I think that there's a sort of central place within the land use strategy as to how we can best site these efforts to improve fruit and vegetable growing, and that with developing technologies, we're getting more flexibility about where that can actually happen, rather than being constrained just on things like soil quality and climatic impacts as well. And I think looking at climate change projections for Scotland, we are likely to see an increase in opportunities for more flexible cropping systems. Having said that, there are also quite substantial risks in terms of loss of productivity in some years because of climate impacts as well. On the basis that if Scotland's experiences and those impacts, other parts of the world are likely to experience them more severely. So I think there's a good case for making Scotland more resilient to impacts elsewhere in the world by being able to produce the sort of foods that we would normally import. What I would add to that, though, is we do need to be a little bit careful not to go down the self-sufficiency route entirely, because international trade is obviously quite an important stabilisation factor, and food is a great example of that. And also to achieve the diversity of foods, we do still need to look at imports as well for diversity of ingredients. So I think in terms of your question, the land use strategy, it has to be integrated with all the other aims and targets that we have for example, increasing the planted area, increasing area for conservation. But I think within that, there is plenty of scope for increasing the, what I would call the self-reliance of Scotland in it being able to produce the, those high quality, high nutritional value food products. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Now move to Beatrice Wishaw.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to ask the panel's views on the link between the right to food and environmental incomes. We know that the key element of long-term food security is environmentally sustainable food production and to enable our food system to continue to produce food for future generations. So I wonder if the panel could give their views on the link between the right to food and environmental outcomes and whether that they think the right to food should be incorporated or otherwise strengthened in the bill.
Kick off with Dr. Shields, please.
Okay, thank you. So without diversity and a healthy environment, we are not going to be able to meet food security needs and food poverty will increase, so it has very direct impacts. Likewise, the way that we are currently producing and consuming food has very damaging impacts on the environment. So it's a two-way process between the environment and our diets. In terms of content on the right to food, I see that in Section 3, there is reference to Article 11 of the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, which includes the right to adequate food. I think that the main content of the main content of the right to food is contained within the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, General Comment 12. So reference should be made to that, which has much more detail in terms of obligations on states in relation to both the production and the availability and affordability and access of food. So just linking to Article 11 is not enough. Linking to the UN General Comment is where all the detail is, and I think that would really give the right to food a much stronger platform in this bill.
And move to Dr. Rivington.
Thank you. I think it's sort of essential that we do have an element of the right to food within the Good Food Nation bill, because I think it's associated with so many other basic fundamental rights, the right to a healthy environment. And I think there's an opportunity here for a very good link to the two things that we tend to think of the environment, we tend to think about food, where our food comes from, and certainly we need to think more about that. And I think if there's an opportunity to link the right to food to the right to clean water, it fits in very neatly with the sustainable development goals. And also, I've referred to as well previously the sort of effectively the psychology of the population in terms of how we view the environment. There's a very strong case to be made that we haven't valued the environment enough, and that to address the climate and biodiversity emergencies, we need to evaluate, we need to value the environment a lot more. And one way that you can do that is actually firming up the links between the right to food and the quality of the environment. And I think that will help a lot with people's attitudes and their perceptions of values if we're able to better value the environment and what it can actually do to us. So I think that the two things are actually really very neatly linked. And I guess I sort of have to pose as sort of the opposite. If you don't have something on the right to food, then it's also sort of negating the right to a healthy environment as well. Thank you.
And Vicky Swales.
Thank you. For us, it's very clear that the right to food includes the right to have food that's produced in environmentally sustainable ways, as has already been indicated. And so we're very clear, the Scottish Government has described the bill as giving practical effect to the right to the food. So for us, it's really important that that purpose is explicitly set out in the bill, that it defines that right to food, which includes the environment, and that it restates the duty on ministers to realise that right and links those duties and powers, giving practical effect to it. A discussion and debate around where that right to food sits in terms of human rights and with forthcoming human rights legislation. But we have a real opportunity now with the Good Food Nation Bill to put that right to food front and centre, and for that to encompass all aspects, that everybody has access to adequate amounts of appropriate food, as I say, and healthy and nutritious food, which is produced in environmentally sustainable ways. So for us, it's a really critical point, and we need to see the bill help to progress that right to food in all its different component parts, but especially around the environmental aspects.
Thank you. And finally on this theme, Ian Gullen.
Yeah, and I guess I'd just echo what others have said in terms of how it fits with kind of that, goes back to that question about policy cohesion around if we're serious about tackling inequalities, then it feels that it's the right thing to do. I mean, clearly for me, anything that's going to help drive the reductions in food waste here in Scotland, get people's attention on that imbalance that we have. I think I said in my earlier remarks around, we globally, we grow enough food for everyone. It's just the supply and distribution of that is really impacting on societies and individuals across the whole world. And we, the amount of food that we waste could potentially feed a huge part of society who are going hungry, both here in Scotland and around the world. And then just picking up on a previous point, we forget all of that food waste. We've talked about carbon emissions, but it's also the important minerals and minerals, etc., and vitamins that are being lost as well. We've done work. We did a recent project with our primary school, which over 4 weeks wasted nearly 200 litres of milk and yogurt. That's the equivalent of the dietary requirements in terms of calcium of 420 children. You start to think about it in that terms as well. The amount of waste that we're producing in terms of our food is not just climatic; it's nutritional. It's our health impact as well that we're wasting. So, thank you.
Thank you. Through that, did you suggest that there should be the right to food incorporated within this bill, or should it be dealt with in other legislation? I don't think that was clear.
No. Yes, in the bill. Yes, in the bill. Yes.
Thanks very much. We'll now move on to our next theme and question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, convener, and thank you very much, panel. It's been a really good conversation this morning, and bringing in things like soil indicators and food waste is moving the conversation on and opening it up. I'm going to pick up on the theme of participation, oversight and accountability. I've got a few questions in this area, and I'm going to start with a question directed to Dr. Shields. I'd like to hear your views on whether the bill provides sufficient opportunity for meaningful participation from food industry workers, stakeholder groups and members of the public, especially people whose voices are seldom heard in the food in food policy design.
As it stands, I don't think there's those provisions present in the bill. I think there's huge opportunity to develop food councils attached to these relevant authorities in terms of making their good food plans. And there's fantastic examples of food councils, particularly from North America, Toronto, and places like Detroit, and also in Europe, in Amsterdam, Copenhagen. So there's great examples of setting up food councils that then might create their own terms of reference in terms of how they meet and how they debate and how they mediate on issues. Or we can look at best case examples from these international examples, but I think that the bill could contain more detail on setting up the councils alongside the creation of the plans and discussing about representation on those councils. At present, I don't think there's much on that at all in the bill. How the plans are going to be created. And
great, thank you very much for that. I'm going to just move it on, and I'd like to hear, staying with you, but I'll come to others, I'd like to hear your thoughts on how a Scottish Food Commission or another body could help ensure that these people's participation or, you know, is an oversight that feeds into the process of drafting the Good Food Nation plans. And if that body should be established before the work takes place.
I think there's huge value in establishing a body, and the other value of establishing a commission is that it will secure commitment to this that transcends electoral cycles, so it will create a certain permanence like the Land Commission has done. And in terms of how the representation of stakeholders on that commission, I think there's a lot to learn from the Land Commission in terms of how they have both engaged, educated and engaged through different kind of mobile roadshows and discussion forums. And I think there has to be an element of shared ownership. There has to be private representation and also public representation.
Thank you very much for that. And Vicky Swales, you had mentioned some kind of Scottish Food Commission earlier in our conversation. Would you like to come in and just expand on that? Dr. Shields has mentioned the Land Commission, and I wonder if that is a good model that we could be picking up here in Scotland in terms of the Good Food Nation Bill.
Thanks. Yes. I think certainly as the bill as it stands at the minute has got really limited just consultation. And so how we get active engagement and participation is a really key thing, I think, in this. And that is definitely something that we see as a role and a function of setting up a statutory food commission will be to support that citizen engagement and participatory democracy. And there's lots of different ways in which we could do that. I think we see that body having quite a number of different functions as alongside that engagement and participation, have an important role in terms of data gathering, helping to monitor and report on progress in relation to, we've had the conversation about setting outcome targets and indicators, and providing sort of scrutiny and evaluation of national and local food plans and relevant policies, ensuring that policy coherence and join up, which I think is really difficult to achieve at the moment because food affects so many different policy areas, so many different ministerial portfolios relevant to so many different committees of this parliament. And it's really difficult to get that scrutiny. So setting up a body with that explicit purpose, which can also then provide advice and guidance on these issues and identify where we may need to make policy changes, et cetera. These are all things I think that could be really important functions of a body. And in that sense, I think we do see some analogies with the Scottish Land Commission and the way it was set up and some of its functions. They're very similar to what I've just described there. I think there's a really important point there about the permanence and going beyond electoral cycles and having a body that builds up that expertise, has staff and resources to look into these sorts of issues and that have the knowledge to do that. So I think it would perform a really important function. And I know there's always issues and concerns raised about setting up new and separate bodies and the costs of those. But I think actually we need to look at it in terms of some of the benefits that it will provide in terms of really giving us driving progress and giving us some of the coherence across all these issues that span the food system and genuinely making progress on this front.
And would Ian Gullan like to comment on that as well?
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I think that is obviously something that is others have pointed out and I agree with, you know, who who is going to certainly oversee the plans, the development of the plans. And it goes back to the point I made about, you know, I think the real strength of the plans would be how they're all aligned and how they support collaborative working. So how do we ensure that is happening? Who's going to hold the various agencies to account in terms of reporting and making progress? And yeah, that important thing about participation to make sure that, you know, there is, you know, all the partners we've talked about, you know, to ensure that collaboration is there. And also just how do we support? I mean, we talk about local authorities who, you know, how do we ensure that the right support is to the individual agencies to develop the plans and deliver on them? So in terms of skills, capacity, you know, who's going to, you know, to some extent brigade organisations like our own, you know, Zero Waste Scotland, to provide the right support and, you know, alongside the participants as well, you know, active citizenship, etc. So, yeah, having a commission or a body established, I think, is, yeah, obviously fundamental to success to a degree. And we'd welcome that and to be part of that.
And Dr. Shields indicated you'd like to come back in.
Yeah, just to say also that some of those international examples state that a major change that occurred through the food councils or a food commission was this move to looking at food issues as shared responsibilities, moving away from individualising food and diet issues. So the Amsterdam programme was on a childhood obesity plan, and by spreading responsibility for this across a very wide range of stakeholders, there was this a cultural change that this childhood obesity wasn't to be left, you know, to individual households to tackle. It was a community problem, and I think that brings huge value.
Okay, now move on to questions from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. I'd like to follow on from Ariane Burgess's question about participation, and interestingly, Dr. Shields, what you were talking about there is a community taking responsibility for an issue. I think it's fair to say that this bill is giving us a fresh approach to seek to embed food within public policy. And a word that's been coming up through all this morning's evidence is coherence, and that coherence across a wide range of areas to create an improved food landscape for everyone and to encourage cultural change. So I'm interested to hear about the participation of how we get people involved. And I think some people, I think Vicky Swales in your evidence proposed a citizens' assembly. So I'm interested to hear about what you think about that across the participants and also other forms of engagement for the creation of these food plans, the national one and also ones in local authorities and other public bodies, but also thinking about, and I was struck by Dr. Rivington's comments very early on about the time imperative of getting this introduced. So perhaps if I start with Vicky Swales.
Thank you. Yes. I think there was a call recently for a Citizens' Assembly of Scotland model to be embedded in Scottish politics and making the principles and practice of participatory democracy a real thing. And we've had some examples of that in terms of a climate assembly. We've also had work in the Scottish Parliament previously looking at not quite the same thing, but in the previous Parliament, the Eclair Committee, for example, had an inquiry into citizens' inquiry into lands management payments, for example. So there are various different models and ways of engaging society, engaging people in these really important issues and getting their lived experiences, getting their ideas, getting their knowledge and informing processes. So I think there is real scope here to think about citizens' food assembly and how that might work. And certainly, I think that's a role in setting that up, which could be given to the establishment of a statutory food commission if we get that. Obviously, these things do take time. They can have some costs associated with them. But again, I think many of the benefits that can flow from doing this and in such a complex area as food, I think could be really significant. And I think it's something we would support And we need to get away from just the idea that we can just sort of do a short consultation and that's sufficient to kind of deal with and identify what are in many cases some really intractable problems with, difficult things to sort out. So greater participation and engagement, absolutely important. And using and looking at all the existing mechanisms we do have. So for example, just struck by comments earlier around the land use strategy, we have piloting regional land use partnerships to produce regional land use frameworks. That's another process of engagement. So we should certainly look across the piece at what we've already got, but I think there's probably scope to significantly build on that and do something new that would feel really quite fresh and ambitious for Scotland.
Okay, thank you. And Dr. Rivington, I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on the time frame versus the importance of the public engagement and getting buy-in.
Thanks, Jenny. Absolutely. I think the time imperative also implies the need to engage with people. And I think there's a really important point about through the engagement, you can help glean all the information needed to address what is a very complex system, the food system, and how it relates to society. But in doing so, if we develop this participation process, and I'll back up exactly what Vicky has just said about the opportunities here, is that then we also need mechanisms by which information is transferred back through sort of networks and process of engagement on best practice on how we actually achieve the range, whether they're targets or whatever the ambitions are. So if it's set up properly, it can be a two-way process. You can gather information from the relevant communities. And I think just an extension to my previous sort of response about issues to do with food production within Scotland, I think that's probably a very important issue to do with things like affordable housing in terms if we're wanting to look to increase production of food within Scotland in rural areas and in urban as well, that having things like affordable housing will help provide the basis on which people are able to take up employment opportunities that arise. So having that engagement with a very wide diversity of involved stakeholders to identify what all the different issues are within how you do the food system transformation will provide the information that we can then use to make decisions and then reverse the flow of information back through those networks on how best to actually implement them as well. Thank you.
Time limits. Do you want to move on?
Okay, we have a supplementary on one of the questions from Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, convener. Yes, I just want to pick up on the Scottish Food Commission and its role a little bit more, or whatever oversight body. And I'm going to direct this question in the interest of time to Ian Gulland. I just think you might have some experience from your work at Zero Waste. So some stakeholders have called for this body to produce an annual state of food progress report, which would reflect how well the country's doing against objectives and or targets in the Good Food Nation plans or possibly in the bill. These reports could be examined by parliamentary committees, just like the UK CCC's progress reports on emission reductions are examined by NZET. So I'm wondering if you believe that this would be an important function over an oversight body and how progress reports could encourage and incentivize the private sector to play its part in delivering a Good Food Nation?
So the simple answer is yes. I think that would be very good. I think, pretty good to this is the reporting. So, and almost real-time reporting, an annual cycle of reporting on progress against actions to, obviously, from our point of view, reducing food waste, then allows us to address, insufficient progress or areas where we're getting greater traction and, ensure that we're learning from that and duplicating it or replicating that across other parts of Scotland. So, absolutely. And, the success of the Climate Commission is that it not only just reports, it gives analysis, it gives scenarios about how to, get back on track, so to speak, and areas of focus, and it brings people to, well, to some extent it holds people to account, different sectors who are potentially not progressing as much as other areas. So absolutely, so something I think that would be, you know, very significantly beneficial to have, and you're right, an annual cycle of that from the oversight. I think the role of private companies, commercial companies, is important. And again, it comes back to the planning. You know, if the planning is done, talked a lot about citizens there, but if that planning for, the development of the plans, both at national level and at local level, includes, you know, industry sectors, businesses, local businesses, as well as national businesses involved in that, you know, then they will feel as accountable to the direct, not just the ambition, but the targets and the reporting as much as anybody else. And they'll be woven into that just as much as individual communities. So I think even that, you know, again, how do we be having an oversight body who would support the input from industry per se, I think would be really useful as well as that citizens. And you know, I think that would encourage greater participation, if not, you know, essential participation by commercial enterprises and third sector enterprises in the food system as well, who might feel a little bit excluded from this process at the moment.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to questions from Jim Fairley. Just in the interest of time, we're running very rapidly out of time. I'm going to ask the members to direct the questions to individual panel members. But if any of the panel members feel that they specifically want to answer it, if they could indicate in the chat, and we'll try and bring you in. Jim.
Thank you, Convener. And I'll direct this to Ian and Kirsten, if that's okay. And it's your views. You might have largely covered this, but I just want to know what your views are on the practical role of public authorities in the Good Food Nation in relation to securing environmental outcomes.
Need to start?
Yes, please, Ian. Yeah.
Yeah, I think certainly they can impact on you know, procurement of food in the supply chain, as I've mentioned already. They can help support the delivery of initiatives locally, you know, to the citizens. So I think there's a real role for them, but it's not just about their own food supply. They can shape wider activity on the ground with their citizens, with businesses. Goes back to that, you know, supporting economic development, supporting particular innovation around the food system, both locally and, you know, in terms of distribution, but also the supply, working collectively, and, you know, also, you know, more importantly, just that strategic support for the wider change that we're trying to create here in Scotland. So I think there's a lot they can do out with just looking at their own food and, you know, supply to schools and etc., which obviously is very important, and they could use that as a driver. They can support and facilitate other action on the ground. Planning as well, shaping planning.
Well, absolutely agree with that. And their powers are limited to the powers that they currently have. So whether they can effectively tackle, you know, being flooded with processed foods and issues of you know, high street issues of who's the main food provider and all of that, that these issues can't easily be tackled by local authorities. Their focus therefore will be on places of public food. There are really great examples from Europe, Italian Casa de Popolos, for instance, which are, you know, kind of community food hubs. There's no stigma attached to them. People go there to read the papers. They have very close ties with farms, whether they are local farms or regional farms, and they have a sense of kind of seasonality about their food system, and food cultures and food processing and all of that. There's a lot of food education that happens within those centres, and really, these stem from post the Second World War era, and maybe that's where we need to pick up from in terms of redressing the food culture in the UK, is to go back and look at what was lost then and how we can recultivate a sense of community around food. and local authorities are very well placed to do that. Powers? And there's also examples from France where a municipality, Moulins-Sartreau, actually bought land in order to supply food, in order to supply school food. And that model has now been replicated in different municipalities, small regions around Europe. It's called biocanteens. So there you see, you know, a reform of not just farming, but the whole food system.
Thank you.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Yeah, I'd like to ask about the relevant authority. The bill sets out that the Scottish ministers and relevant authorities must have regard to the Good Food Nation plans when exercising their specified functions. So could you share your views on who should be designated a relevant authority in terms of the bill? And could I go to Dr. Shields, please?
Sorry, the question was...
Yeah, who you think should be designated a relevant authority in terms of the bill?
So councils?
Yeah,
local councils? Local authority councils, yes.
Does anybody else want to come in on that?
I suppose the question is... where does the limit? Is it just local authorities, health boards, or are there other public bodies that should be described as relevant authorities? Anybody want to come in on that? Ian?
We've got through all the different agencies and authorities in the public realm. You would hope that everybody would take recognition of basically the national plan and the local plan, and certainly either voluntary or become part of it. You know, set their own ambitions and think about it. I'm thinking about, you know, prisons, for instance, who, you know, are obviously a great user of food. And again, you know, comes back to that collaborative nature about procurement. If we're serious about changing some of the way the systems of supply of food here in Scotland, you know, we need all the public agencies to be involved in it and to be accountable to it, and it's not just the health boards and the local authorities. There's probably a whole range of other agencies that could be part of this.
Vicky Swales wanted to come in. Just in addition to Beatrice's question, should there be a list of relevant authorities in the face of the bill? Vicky, and then Mike.
Thanks. I think obviously some of the main ones are the health boards and local authorities, but just I was thinking about the previous question and thinking about public authorities and bodies which own land. And so if we're thinking about how public land is managed in various ways and in reducing our environmental footprint, whether there's scope to be doing an assessment of that and thinking how that public land is used in relation to our food system generally, as well as the obvious functions around their roles in procurement and shortening supply chains and stimulating and encouraging food production in local areas. So there may well be some other bodies that own land that are not explicitly for food production purposes at the moment that could be looked at in the context and have a role to play here.
And Mike.
Thank you. I just wanted to sort of add to that the role of organisations such as NatureScot and SEPA, obviously from the perspective of maintaining sustainable food supplies within Scotland, the importance of maintaining environmental quality and the role that NatureScot and SEPA can actually play within that as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And Rachel Hamilton.
I was really interested in what I think it was Mike said about changing this mind and behaviour of people and their psychology. But 21 out of the 66 consultees to the consultation on the Good Food Bill said that food education is an important part of a Good Food Nation. We know that food education is currently in the curriculum, but it is not core and it's deemed as possibly a secondary subject. So do witnesses believe that food education should be on the face of the Good Food Nation bill. Can I start with Mike?
Thank you, Rachel. Yes, I think it should be, and I think there are good opportunities here as well, as I said before, of making that link between food education and environmental education. And if we're trying to sort of foster a sort of a culture of care within our society, understanding where food comes from, how best to prepare it, and what the consequences of our choices are in terms of impact on the environment, then I think there's good opportunities here for the bill make connection to the curriculum about how we educate our young people about the value of the environment and how ecosystems function, and most importantly, if they don't function, what the threats are then to food security. So there's a very neat sort of multi-way sort of link between that. So yes, I think there's really good opportunities for embedding education about food within the bill, and then broadening it to wider issues to do with education as well. And the Committee on Climate Change have made very clear that some of the solutions to climate change are due to behaviour change, and some of the best ways you can achieve behaviour change is through education of young people and influence on parents. So yes, I think absolutely there's definitely scope within the bill for firmer education. Thank you.
Can I go to that's a great answer. Can I go to Vicky, please?
Thanks, yes. It's not something necessarily that Scottish Environment Link have a particular position on, so it's perhaps more a personal view, but I fully endorse what Mike's just said there. I think it's absolutely something that would be really valuable to do, and tying it in with that understanding about the environment, about where the impacts on the environment come from, and given what we've said about the critical role that our food system plays in that. But also thinking about the future and some of the solutions, I think, again, totally agree with Mike that young people will determine the future and are the future, and their views on this will be really already seeing quite a lot of concern around biodiversity loss and climate change. I think young people are making some of those connections, but I think embedding some of these issues in the national curriculum would obviously be clearly beneficial as well in issues.
No time. Could I go to Ian, please?
Said, I think we shouldn't avoid the fact that education is so important, and that we obviously have done quite a bit of work with Education Scotland and developing curriculum materials for obviously around food waste, with our real positive response, and we continue to work with schools individually and collectively. And again, that's another role for local authorities on a practical level to support such programmes. And we know from survey work that we did in the run-up to COP26, that people didn't really, there was a very low threshold of awareness in the population more generally about the impacts of food waste in terms of climate change, and obviously we've seen a huge shift in people's awareness around plastics, but, plastic waste at home food waste at home is three times the impact of plastic waste at home in terms of the environment. So getting simple messages across to people and targeting schools, getting that education, getting people at an early stage to understand the wider impacts, but opportunities around, changing, whether that's diet, whether that's access to food, or, how they consume and waste and not waste food, hugely important. And I absolutely, think that's critical to the success of the bill going forward.
Thank you very much. And we'll now move on to Jenny for our final questions.
Thank you, Convener. And actually, kind of following on from what Ian was talking about there, last week we took some evidence from Shetland Food and Drink about the impact of supermarkets opening up and the impact that has on local suppliers of food. So I'm interested to hear your thoughts on the role of the private sector in a Good Food Nation. I mean, I find I walk around supermarkets and try and avoid to buy things with plastic, but it's how can the Good Food Nation bill help change perhaps not only the decision making of local authorities but perhaps the private sector as well? So I'd be interested to know your thoughts on that. Ian, I don't know if you want to start and then perhaps go to Kirsteen.
Yeah, I mean, just to touch upon this, I think there is huge opportunity. I mean, certainly from local authorities, again, if it's a more participative, collaborative nature, clearly both at national and local level, to include the private sector in terms of retail as well, involved in that. And I think you will find willing partners, certainly in the conversations that we have, strategic level with some of those operators. You know, there is they understand that they have a role to play, but they know that they can't do it alone, that they want to work with, whether that's, you know, local authorities or local agencies on the ground and local communities. So I think it comes back to that. But also going back to the point of influence, you know, I think, you know, a collaborative nature of all 32 local authorities working together on the supply and changing the way that food is presented or, you know, distributed, you know, both formally and informally, through the Scottish supply chain, they could actually start to influence that. And that's why I saw at COP26, an awakening almost of not just Scottish cities, but global cities understanding, because they actually pull in 99% of their food from out with their areas, they could start to really influence how the big corporates collectively. So everybody thinks these big corporates are the, you know, the, to some extent the barrier, and we have to get them on side. But if our local authorities were, you know, could get together collaboratively, they could start to influence that more directly, rather than them all individually trying to change the way that the big supermarkets act. And, you know, we could do that here in Scotland, and then find partnerships in other parts of the world, and, you know, the real change that we're trying to see could happen.
Thank you, and Kirstine.
Well, given what's said about we can't necessarily rely on change through individual choice and procuring and providing for sustainable places for communal food is a really good way to pump prime local production, so that local production can scale up and become the kind of preferred choice. Is a good way to increase availability of local food. And then with the Good Food Nation plan, I think there's a huge opportunity to change the messaging around food and to make healthy environmental choices the easy choice, the preferred choice. And that would mean, you know, greater availability of local produce on the high street, perhaps, or, you know, farm shops or markets. But there definitely needs to be greater diversity. Or supermarkets have kind of got us here and got us to this situation. So we need to look at more farm direct sources of food.
Dr. Rivington.
What this raises is some very sort of uncomfortable truths about the way that the food system operates and effectively where the money goes. Johnny Hall from the NFUS raised a really good point in one of your previous sessions about farmers, producers being squeezed at one end and consumers being squeezed at the other, and basically asking the question, where does the money go? So that implies what the imperative is profit orientation. And I think what we need in terms of the food system transformation is a shift towards both a sustainability and resilience orientation for environmental quality, for food security, but also the profit motivation as well. It's blending the two things together. So I think the private sector has a key role to it to play in this. But sometimes we feel it's a bit like a David and Goliath type situation because of the power and influence of the food system. And globally, there's about 110 key buyers that influence where food comes from and how it's grown and where it goes. So influencing them towards increasing levels of sustainability is absolutely essential. So I think the private sector has a key role to play in it, but within this bill there needs to be a lot of influence asserted to try and steer their profit motivation towards sustainability as well. Thank you.
And finally, Vicky Swales.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I think there's two ways. Clearly, there's a very big role for the private sector in relation to making Scotland a good food nation. I think the stronger this bill is in terms of its clarity of purpose in defining what we mean by that, in setting targets, having scrutiny and accountability mechanisms and reporting, in a way, all helps the private sector understand where we're going to and what the responsibilities are, what needs to be done. Clearly, some food businesses and many others are making progress and arguably are maybe more ahead of where the public sector is on some fronts. But I think we need that clear direction of travel. So that's one way the Good Food Nation Bill can help. But I think the other way is to pick up on comments from other panellists is just thinking about our current food supply chains that are very long. There's some big corporations in those. And a lot of we create shorter supply chains. How do we connect primary producers to consumers? How do farmers, crofters, fishers make a better living from the food that they produce? And from that, what benefits can flow, both economic benefits, but also environmental benefits from having a more localised food system? It requires having some local processing capacity. And we need to be thinking about how grants and public money and other things support some of that. But I think there's a lot of benefit in that. There's a lot of a lot of work looking at the benefits of shorter supply chains at EU level and through the Farm to Fork strategy, for example. And I think for Scotland, there's some real benefits in terms of creating a more not only environmentally sustainable but resilient food system for Scotland, really, really connecting people in local ways, consumers and producers. And of course, there's benefits that flow from that in terms of thinking about people who come to Scotland and consume food, to Scotland's tourism industry, from having a food offer which is of high quality, local, sustainably produced food. And getting to that point, I think then the national food plans and local food plans are clearly ways in which we can identify where the opportunities are and how that could be achieved and how we can make progress on that front.
Thank you very much. Ian, Mike, Kirstine and Vicky, thank you very much for giving evidence this morning. It's very much appreciated and it will certainly help us form our report into the draft bill. So thank you very much. We'll now suspend this meeting until 10:50 to allow the changeover in witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. And we return to the evidence on the Good Food Nation Bill, and we're hearing from our second panel focusing on policy outcomes relating to public health. And to this session, I welcome Dr. Isabel Fletcher, the Senior Research Fellow from the University of Edinburgh, Claire Hislop, Organisational Lead for Diet, Physical Activity and Healthy Weight from Public Health Scotland, Jill Murray, Public Health Programme Manager from Glasgow Centre for Population Health, and Joe Tees, the Project Manager from the British Dietetic Association. Excuse me. I'll start with questions. We've got until approximately 10 past 12 for questions. So I'll kick off. What I would like to understand is your understanding of what is meant by a good food nation, and also whether you agree that the bill as drafted will enable Scotland to achieve that ambition. And could I start with Dr. Fletcher, please?
Hello. Thank you, everybody, for giving me this opportunity to speak. I have a really simple definition of a good food nation, which is one where everyone has access to nutritious and sustainably produced food, prices they can afford, and they don't have to worry about that access. I also think it would involve everyone working in the food industry, so in manufacturing, retailing, and catering, being paid a decent wage for the work that they do. I know that that is a simple definition that covers a lot of complex policy issues. I think we talk too much when we talk about Scotland as a good food nation. We focus on production and exports. We don't focus enough on our domestic consumption. And I think we need to think more about the kind of the day-to-day effects of what Food Standards Scotland calls bad diets, the fact that everybody eats badly in Scotland, and this is reflected in our health statistics, and that the least well-off eat worst of all. So we need to reverse this this historical pattern that Food Standards Scotland has been reporting on this in 15 years, and it hasn't changed significantly. I will leave others who have more expertise in this area to fill in on the detail of the kind of public health aspects of Good Food Nation. I would say that the bill as stands, it's a start, but there are gaps in it. There are gaps around targets, around implementation, and around public participation. And I think we need a statutory body to fill in some of these gaps.
Okay, thank you. Claire Hislop.
Hi there, and thanks for inviting me along today. Our vision, I think, for a good food nation would be similar to what you've probably heard from a lot of the other evidence committees. It is about having that kind of acceptable, easy access to affordable food that promotes nutrition for everybody. And I think we need to really focus in on the sort of reduction in inequalities around this as well. We want people who are informed about the food they eat and where it comes from. And we also, I would, for me, a good food nation would be things that obviously look much wider than that, things like the environmental impacts and obviously how we can maximise income both for our businesses and obviously the workforce around that as well. We really welcome the bill. We think it's a really good opportunity how we can strengthen policies across Scotland. We have a very complex food policy across Scotland, but also there's lots of other wider policies that impact on how we are able to achieve the ambitions of being acceptable, affordable and obviously nutritious as well as being sustainable. I think for me, one of the things that we would really want the bill to strengthen on is having a clearer purpose and outlining what we need to do to achieve this. We all know about the increasing statistics around Scotland's poor diet, than those living with a higher body weight. And this is often exacerbated by inequalities as well. We know that it's not just about our diets affect our health, but not just our physical health, our mental health as well. And it also has massive knock-on effects on budgets for our NHS and also our workforce. I think it was mentioned earlier in the session around our recent publication of BMIs for Primary 1 stats, which has seen a stark increase in children who are experiencing risk overweight and obesity just in this last year, which kind of brings into the forefront the impact that the pandemic has also had on our food systems and obviously people's health outcomes as well. So I think for us, the bill, you know, has a real opportunity to change things, but we do believe that public health needs to be at the heart of this and that prevention is absolutely key here, and that, you know, people's weight is not just about an individual thing. We need to think about much more holistically this, and it's not simply about eating less and moving more. We need to change the current food environment that we're in to have easy access to the kind of acceptable and affordable food that we need to do. So we hope that the bill has a role to play in this. Thank you.
Thank you. And Jill Murray.
Thanks very much, and thanks for inviting me along today. For us, I speak on behalf of the Glasgow Centre for Population Health, but also the Glasgow Food Policy Partnership, and we've been developing over the last 7 or 8 years, really, a Glasgow City Food Plan that was recently launched. So really, I'm speaking from my experience in both of those areas. But for us, a vision for our Good Food Nation would be one that supports our ambitions for an inclusive, sustainable, healthy, resilient and fair Scotland. Our food system should support all of our aspirations for the country. And, you know, in terms of public health, you know, as Claire said, you know, we've got a number of really pressing public health issues that relate to our food system. We have a significant dietary related illness, including overweight and obesity, but going beyond that to other chronic illnesses. And we see significant inequalities in those. And those inequalities are unfortunately increasing, as Claire indicated as well. We also have significant food insecurity, and this existed before the pandemic, but has been exacerbated by the pandemic. And so the poorest in our country experience a double burden of not only being unable to eat healthily in a way that supports their health, but actually struggling to afford adequate food on a daily basis. And that burden particularly falls on lone parents and the children they live with, and on our population who are living with disabilities and ill health. We see them significantly more likely to be food insecure. And the other public health issue that obviously you've been listening to in your other sessions is the climate emergency. The climate and nature emergencies are probably the greatest public health issue that we will be facing going forward. And our food system is really central to addressing that. So in terms of the Good Food Nation Bill, we really welcome it. We think it's a great opportunity. We particularly welcome the framework approach, which gives us a real opportunity to build greater coherence and coordination across the whole food system, which, as you know, is really complex. The gaps we feel, very much agree with other speakers, in that the gaps we think there must be a much clearer purpose and direction and ambition within that gives everybody a kind of roadmap. Where are we trying to get to? What do we think collectively we want to see for our food system going forward in Scotland? We would like to see a statutory body for overseeing that. We'd like to see clearer targets, and we'd like to see participation built into that.
Thank you very much, Jill. And Joe Tees, please.
Good morning, and thank you. Welcome to the committee. I'm a registered dietitian. I work in the NHS as a project manager supporting the implementation of the framework for the prevention and remission of type 2 diabetes. I'm here this morning on behalf of the British Dietetic Association, representing the views of the approximate 1,000 dietitians in Scotland. I'm also a member of the Allied Health Professions Federation Scotland. Dietitians work across health, social care, justice and housing. We provide evidence-based nutrition and dietetic advice, and we're regulated by the Health, Care and Professions Council. I think I would very much echo Claire's comments around her definition of the Good Food Nation. We, as a professional body, are supportive of the bill. We feel it's ambitious, and again, echoing much of what's been said this morning, it will rely very strongly on partnership and co-production. Thank you.
Thank you. And move to question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. It was really just to ask perhaps Dr. Fletcher and Claire Hislop about the, you've mentioned the importance issue of the food environment that there is in Scotland, and I think we would all agree about how that needs to be changed. But of course, I'm sure you'd also agree, without putting words in your mouth, that we can't divorce this from the issue of incomes. And while I appreciate some of the levers around determining what incomes are, whether through wages or through benefits, are preserved, I just wondered if you could say a bit about how you think a good food nation be in terms of incomes.
Who would like to kick off on that one? Claire Hislop?
Yeah, and I'm happy to come in. Yeah, I think we can disjoint the two. And I think, obviously, this, as I mentioned earlier, the whole issue of wider policy areas and us not, through the Good Food Nation Bill, just focusing in purely on food policy, I think we need to look at the wider aspects of this. As we say, and I think the pandemic's exacerbated, there is obviously an issue here around people having the ability to purchase food with dignity, food that they want to purchase, and how they choose to do that. I don't know if I've got the answer here, but I think certainly we need to look at how we work with our industries around things like the living wage, how we're maximising our incomes with people, for example, in low-income communities. I mean, some of the work that we do with community groups is even to provide, for example, advice when they're maybe attending things like lunch clubs, etc., about how they maximise things like their benefits and making sure that people are obviously claiming everything that they need to as well. But I think we need to look at this holistically, you know, obviously linking up with our colleagues and trying to maximise income to ensure that we do have access to healthier food. So I think one of the other things as well is not to think about this in isolation and looking at our wider policies, even things like the planning framework, to ensure that people have access locally so we've not got additional costs as things like transport. We'll need to look as obviously increasing energy bills, etc., begin to rise, how that will impact on the wider population as well. So we'll need to take all these things into account as we progress through the bill as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. Fletcher.
I would echo most of those comments. I would add that I think affordability is largely an issue of incomes, which I understand is not A, easy to solve, and B, something that's necessarily within the power of the Scottish Government. But historically, agricultural workers, people in catering and retail have been amongst the lowest paid occupations. So we have this situation where the people who work in the food system are often the people who can afford the food least. So we need to think, as the previous witness said, systemically and holistically about how we change that situation. I realise I don't have any answers, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Move on to a question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask in regards to target setting. We had a discussion in the last panel in regards to collaboration and the fragmentation, which may happen if there's no agreed prioritised view for goal setting and the danger of gaps. For example, Rachel asked about obesity targets and rightly mentioned how this is not just a food issue. It is also attributed to access to certain food quality and other variables in our environments, precarious socioeconomic conditions, which cause poverty and health-related inequalities. Child poverty is a driver of obesity in children, we know that, much like the poverty-related attainment gap. When one goes up, the others follow. So, for example, wouldn't it be setting up to fail? So just use obesity as an example. If we have a target for obesity in this plan, which is highly dependent on welfare reforms and mitigations, is there a danger there that we're shifting focus when we should be looking at a more holistic view, culture change, embedding good food into our public services, looking at levers, performance, monitoring, and all of the natural consequences as well from that, rather than be led by the nose by targets which may take us off course? I'll just open that up to the panel who would like to come in, perhaps. Joe.
If Joe could kick off, please.
I think that's quite a challenging question, and I don't have a position. I can see Jill on my screen, so I thought Jill was speaking, but no, it's myself. apologies. I don't have a position, but I can go away and come back with a position from our professional association. Food poverty, we know particularly, we see many examples as dietitians across the whole of the public health spectrum. So it's not only food poverty, it's also around food sustainability as well. So I'm going to defer to the other experts on the panel first, and feel free to come back to me.
Can we move to Jill now, please?
Yep. Yeah. So I agree that targets can be problematic, but I also agree with some of the speakers from previous sessions that they're really important. They're really important for bringing people together with a common purpose. And so I think targets are a really important part of this bill, but not the only thing. I think for example, independent scrutiny of the bill to look regularly at the progress towards those targets and to get underneath that, again, using participative approaches, understanding what's happening in terms of the implementation. So sometimes targets are not hit, not because the target is wrong, but because the implementation has failed for some reason. And that could be due to an external thing, like, you know, prevailing economic issues or a pandemic or government policy from elsewhere, or it could be because something happened that stopped the correct implementation within something within which government has more control over. And so we need to set targets, we need to work towards those targets, we need to collaborate in agreeing those targets, and those targets must be linked vertically through our governance system to the National Performance Framework, to our SDGs, but they also must be looked at not in isolation, but as part of the whole Good Food Nation approach and how actually we are making progress towards them. So they need to be linked to indicators that show our progress through the short, medium and long term, and so that we can, through our scrutiny process, identify if we're not actually hitting that target, or if there's some perverse incentive on the way, or if indeed the target is not challenging enough. But we need the targets, but we need other things built in to scrutinise, review and evolve the approach that we're taking over time to make sure that we are being as ambitious as possible, but taking into account any challenges that we might meet along the way.
And Claire Hislop.
Thank you. So, I mean, I think sometimes it's about the kind of terminology people use as well, about kind of, for me, some of the kind of ambition and aspirations we've got quite often seem quite far removed. And I think we need to recognise that this is a long-term goal. For example, to change, obviously, the obesity levels that we see in Scotland is not going to happen overnight. And sometimes having really ambitious targets mean that we don't see the successes we want, so we see it as a failure when it's not actually, and we've moved a long way in the right direction. Just to give an example of that, I've been heavily involved in the kind of school food agenda over the last 20 years, and we've done a huge amount of work working with caterers, education, parents and the young people themselves to take school food from, you know, a place where it was very much about chips with everything to, you know, healthy balanced meals. We've also done work around, you know, our increase to kind of free school meals. We've got our Best Start scheme. We've got all these things going on, really kind of ambitious and really well thought through policies. Despite that, we're still seeing rise in obesity figures. And that's because we don't have that kind of policy cohesion elsewhere. And so I think we do need, for example, high-level ambitions, but I also think we need targets for implementation so that we have dates to work to, so we can start to see how these things to come together, that we can share good practice and actually look for where the unintended consequences are amongst other policy areas to start to better align these. So I think, you know, I think we do need to outline what we want to do within this bill and actually have clear indicators of how we will measure, both in terms of implementation, but also longer term goals as well. And I think we need to set them out both in the national plan and obviously within the local plans, which hopefully echo these, obviously allowing a flexibility depending on their circumstances. But I think there's a real opportunity here to drive change forward with targets, ambitions for implementation, but clear indicators as well for how we would track that as well to make sure we're having the change that we need to see happening across Scotland. Thank you.
And Dr. Fletcher?
I would mostly echo what everyone else has said. I would say the key thing is that targets are important for coordinating activities across different policy areas. They create a kind of shared, they are the basis for a shared monitoring, implementation and monitoring. Without targets, it's hard to see how we could achieve this policy, the policy coherence that you need to drive change in this area. I would also say we have a lot of these targets already. A lot of it is not about creating new targets. It's about monitoring the ones that we have, the progress towards the ones we have. So the Scottish dietary goals, the food waste targets, the childhood obesity things, the childhood obesity rates. We're not talking about necessarily creating a whole new set of targets. We're talking about monitoring the progress towards important sets of targets that we've already agreed on.
Yeah, that was really helpful. Thank you. And I agree, we do already have so many other targets. And I think that's what I wanted to pull out of this as well, is, you know, all stakeholders have obviously their own part to play in this, but already have targets set. So it's how do we work that in with this bill, but not setting the targets and having to prioritise those within the bill itself, but everybody having a collaborative approach. That was really helpful. Thank you.
Okay, move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Fletcher's already identified that there are existing policies that could possibly run in parallel to the Good Food Nation Bill. Are there current policies or forthcoming legislation that you would like to see that the Good Food Nation Bill addresses? And that's notwithstanding the comments that have been made on the current possible need for targets. And are there new policies that could change dietary habits that you would like to see as part of the Good Food Nation Bill? I'll start with Claire.
Thank you. And I think just to kind of mention, obviously, as earlier, we have talked about this kind of policy coherence, and we already have lots of good policies out there, and obviously bills. I mean, likewise, I would echo what people said earlier about the kind of targets that we already have. You know, Scottish dietary goals is something we really need to continue to work, you know, towards. I think, obviously, for example, we have the National Planning Framework 4 bill coming sort of through just now, and I think that's a really key area we need to link up with in terms of public health and actually the Good Food Nation to achieve, obviously, our ability to look at how decisions are made locally, and obviously they can give cognizance to some of the targets, say for example how planning decisions would affect moving towards the Scottish dietary goals. You know, that might be something that we want to sort of set and train. We've also got a lot of other policies. So for example, Scottish Government published their out of home action plan last September. Obviously I would want to see that and the work that we plan to do with that included within here. The other thing is the forthcoming public health bill as well. And obviously that has links to things for like restrictions on promotions of high fat, salt, sugar foods. again, an area that obviously we would like to include. But I mean, I can't echo enough the kind of wider aspects of all the other policy areas that need to be included in this as well, around kind of our environmental, maximising income, and obviously really with a whole focus on this is around reducing the kind of inequalities that we see in Scotland. So we would really like to see that strengthened within the bill as well, about making sure that everything that we do and everything we link up to has a focus on reducing that as well. Thank you.
Oh. Jo, could I go to you?
Yes, so as Claire's clearly articulated, there's already current policy out there, particularly as dietitians and a professional association. We align a lot of work to the diet and healthy weight team at the Scottish Government, to the childhood obesity work, the draft malnutrition policy, the healthier future and the prevention and remission of type 2 diabetes, the public health priority 6 as well. Is something that we support, and we would hope that this bill would align closely to. I think Claire's already alluded to very much that whole systems approach as well, and the potential forthcoming legislation around outdoor advertising, and as Claire mentioned, high fat, high sugar foods as well. We would hope that all of that would be aligned within the bill. Thank you.
To develop the question and go to Jill, in Glasgow, where you are running your programme, how difficult or how achievable do you think it would be to put the goals in parallel alongside the Good Food Nation Bill to deliver it locally as part of a multi-strategy ambition?
So I don't think it would be difficult, because the way we've set up is with a view to Good Food Nation Bill coming along, and we've taken and we would review our approach in line with what comes out of the Good Food Nation Bill. Where we started was a recognition that we had loads of brilliant work happening and lots of really good policies. They were happening in isolation of each other. It was very disjointed, and oftentimes some of the good work was happening in spite of, rather than because of, the support it was getting from national, local and policy. So what we were trying to do was build a coherent citywide approach that brought together our stakeholders in a collaborative way to achieve not just more coherent outcomes, but actually a synergistic approach, where by what we're finding is that actually when people get involved, it becomes more beneficial and we make faster progress when our partners, for example, our Child Healthy Weight Programme received funding because of its extensive collaborative approach. So it does become beneficial when you get to that point. So that collaborative approach and the coherent approach we found really helpful. In terms of how easy it is, well, what we did in terms of thinking and going back to the target setting approach, we pulled together all the policies and the policy areas that we could see intersected with the food system and said, well, what are all our stakeholders, what are they committed to achieving in terms of targets, and where is the coherence there? And so we haven't set new targets. We have drawn on the existing targets that are currently set out in lots of different policy documents and pulled them together in our plan. And then we've set out a range of actions, short, medium and long-term actions over the next 10 years, which will be reviewed regularly in terms of our progress towards these, taking into account how our partnership evolves and how policy evolves over that time. So we'll have regular two-yearly scrutiny of that approach. So I, in answer to your question, I think it's actually really important to have that vertical integration, and I don't think it is difficult. The way that we're doing it in Glasgow City is by having our partnership, which is an independent group, and we report to the Public Health Scrutiny Committee, which reports into the community planning process. And so there is collaborative governance built into our approach, which we found really helpful. And we have our community food partners around the table as well, which gives us the opportunity to hear from the range of people that are doing really interesting, really joined up, really whole systems approach at a really ultra local level. And we can learn from them what's working, what's not working, and where the policies are working in conflict on the ground. Because oftentimes what you can have is a policy that looks good at city level in one part of the system, and another policy, perhaps in health, And when you're trying to implement those at a super local level, they don't. It's difficult to do that in an integrated way. And so we're getting that feedback from our community partners, and then we are in the position to try and address some of those challenges at a city level. Having that support nationally would be really helpful, because as a city, we can only achieve so much. We are trying to do stuff as part of our city region approach as well, which brings together the partners round about, where potentially there may be more food production, and that's really helpful. But taking a Scotland-wide approach and having direction from Scotland would help to, it would give more levers, and it would give us a stronger direction. There are, in other bits of Scotland, there are sustainable food places partnerships working. So we're part of a sustainable food place approach, which is a UK-wide scheme, and there are a number of those in Scotland, and we meet with the sustainable food places groups on a regular basis as well to try and bring coherence and share our learning between those different areas. And if the whole country was doing that, that would give us even more opportunity to share learning, to share resources so that we're not duplicating, and to bring greater coherence to everything that we're doing across the country.
Thank you.
Move to Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Children and young people across Scotland have stated how food insecurity affects them. In 2016, one child pointed out, when you're hungry, all you can think about is food. And another spoke of the impact of food insecurity on learning, stating, it's really hard to concentrate. Children also talked about the potential impact of financial insecurity and not having enough to eat, stating that children feel upset, stressed, worried and scared. And this is absolutely heartbreaking, and, you know, who couldn't fail to be moved by that? But the factors in this statement are not really exclusive to just good or bad food. It's about a whole raft of measures needed to ensure food security, which would all be covered in the new Human Rights Bill. How does the panel confront the potential issue for conflicts and duplication with existing legislation and work streams if we looked at implementing the right to food within this bill?
Kick off with Dr. Fletcher.
Some of that is probably beyond my expertise. I agree there is the potential for duplication. I would hope that the legislation is written so that there are no conflicts. But I have two kind of higher level points I want to make about putting the right to food in this bill. One is, it's a way of making sure that the Scottish Government meets international obligations, such as those under the Sustainable Development Goals. And I think that's really important. The other one is that it would have a huge symbolic value. It would show that the Scottish Government values food and good food in a way that I think would signal a change in our national approach to food. So I think symbolically it's really important. I'm inclined to say, as a researcher, that I leave the kind of duplication and inconsistency approach to the people drafting the legislation, because that is not my area of expertise.
Claire Hislop.
Thank you.
I mean, in terms of the right to food, we certainly feel that the bill should set a standard for what people should expect, and should be at the centre of what we do in becoming a good food nation. We support the right for food to be enshrined in Scottish law so that people can access that acceptable, affordable, nutritious food with dignity. Implementing a rights-based approach to food, and specifically with a rights-based approach around food poverty, has the potential influence to affect household insecurity, food insecurity, reduce nutrition-related inequalities, and also improve health. So we believe this should be obviously done, but at what route this should be put in, whether, you know, within the forthcoming human rights legislation or within the Good Food Nation Bill, again, I think we would leave that to others. I think what we would say is that in terms of the timing. We want this to move swiftly, you know, with the bill alongside. We wouldn't want any sort of delay in this happening. But also we'd want to look at where it would have most impact. You know, what levers are in place within each bill to ensure that this is actually implemented effectively and that obviously people are held to account for this as well. So I think in terms of our position, it would be where it's going to be most impactful. But it certainly should be given consideration within this bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jyotis?
Yeah, I guess a couple of points to make in relation to the question. Some of the question is without the scope of my expertise. However, the British Dietetic Association did make a position statement in March 2020 around food poverty, that nobody should live in food poverty and that the UK government and local authorities must take urgent action to lift people out of food poverty and prevent others falling into poverty, and very much supported enshrining a right to food within UK law. We've seen on the ground during COVID, those nutrition related inequalities have been widening. So for example, pressures during homeschooling, holiday hunger. So just a couple of examples of nutrition related inequalities linking back to food poverty and the right to food.
And Jill Murray.
Thanks. I absolutely agree that the scale of food insecurity and the experience of particularly our children is really unacceptable for a country like Scotland. And you know, I absolutely agree that we need to be addressing that. In terms of incorporating the right to food into this bill, we think it's really important. It sends a message, as others have said, but it also helps ensure that our food system is rooted in and coherent with the environmental and the social justice agendas. And it means that all policies must ensure that they're not negatively impacting on people's right to food. So I think it brings important checks and balances into the system and goes beyond children's experience of food insecurity to making sure that all policies maximise people's ability to be able to access, afford healthy, sustainable food. And I think it helps us meet our international obligations as well in terms of the SDGs. In terms of where it sits, my understanding of framework legislation is that the Good Food Nation Bill sets out and other legislation can go into more detail, and there should be coherence and coordination between them. So long as the two are linked, I think that's the really, really important bit. Where the detail lies, I think, is really probably up for some debate.
Thank you. We'll now move on to our next theme. Questions from Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. I would like to just ask a question about participation and is the bill strong enough to ensure we have the right participation in the creation of the Good Food Plans? Both Jill and Claire have given examples of where that work has happened. So maybe you could expand a bit more on that in connection with the bill. And I think, Dr. Fletcher, you mentioned that perhaps there was gaps in the bill with regards to participation. If you could expand on that, please. So we'll start with Dr. Fletcher.
So, thank you. I think the work that Jill Murray has outlined is really impressive, and it provides a really good model for the sort of participation that we need to make this successful, to change food environments. I think we have I would echo, I think it's Nourish Scotland that said that we need to actually go out. And when we're talking about citizen participation, we need to go out and talk to the groups who are most affected by the problems in the food system, and they highlighted those living in food and with food insecurity, and farmers are another key group. And we can't rely on people responding to consultations. We need to go out. I'm using a kind of royal we here, but the government needs to go out, researchers need to go out and actively engage people in these conversations and get their lived experience, because I think it was Mary Brennan who said in the very first session, we will learn so much from them. I've done a little bit of research in rural areas in Scotland and England, talking to people about their food shopping, and people are very engaged in the topic of food. They have experiences that they want to share, experiences and knowledge. So I think this is really important. I think there are interesting models. Vicky Swale talked about, in particular last time, talked about citizens' assemblies. And there's a lot of, we have expertise in the same university around citizen participation. There are a lot of models we can draw on. So I wouldn't want to set a particular model at this stage. I just think it needs to be much more about a kind of roadshow, going out to people and organisations and learning from them. And I think I'll stop there.
And I think in the last session we also got the comments about the time frame and ensuring that there was also an iterative process, so everything was learnt from. Jill, I'd be really interested to hear more from you with regard to participation and how we can ensure the plans are covered.
Yeah, okay. I mean, I think participation is really, really vital. As many people have said in your sessions, people have a real interest in food and they have lots of experience to share, and people in different bits of the country and living in different circumstances have quite different experiences of it, and I think it's really important to hear from them. So I think the bill could do much more to strengthen the participation side of it. I think that having a statutory food commission could oversee that, and I think that would be an excellent role for them. And I think different approaches to participation will be really important, and not relying on one particular approach. Citizens' Assembly is, I think, a good thing to consider, although it does take time and it does take resource. But if we're talking about food being a priority and being urgent and being so central to so many parts of what we're trying to achieve as a country, I think that careful consideration should be given to that. But I also don't think we should lose sight of the fact that we already have a tremendous range of participatory approaches that exist across Scotland, and we need to draw on that expertise and on those existing structures. So within local authorities and within community networks, there is a tremendous amount of expertise around supporting the engagement and participation of local people. And so I think we need to draw on that. And I think there is, particularly over the last couple of years, been some really amazingly innovative practice that have been driven by the need to do things differently because of the pandemic. And so, you know, just talking to people like the Scottish Centre for Community Development and other specialists in engaging people would be really helpful here, as well as our community food networks and our third sector partners. So I think there's a lot to draw on. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. And I think we need to draw on different methods for different stakeholder groups, because whilst getting the lived experience of people living in different communities is really important, getting views from different stakeholders is also really important, and there'll be different approaches. For example, engaging with private sector colleagues takes quite a different approach. And so building in relationships with chambers of commerce and other small business organisations is really important. And similarly, engaging with food producers and farmers is really important, and there are different approaches to doing that across the country. Also, local authorities are increasingly building up their participative approaches that they're taking to developing local authority-wide policies and reviewing those. And you know, there are opportunities for building in deliberation about Good Food Nation into some of those. So I think, you know, as I say, I don't think you need to set up everything from scratch, although, as I say, a Citizens' Assembly is something that would be should be given some careful consideration, but drawing on the range of other fantastic things that are already underway and drawing on the expertise of people who are really skilled in engaging, empowering and supporting participation of people would be really important.
Okay, thank you, Jill. Claire, have you got anything to add? I think in your...
I think Jill's covered quite a...
Yes, she did.
Jill's obviously covered quite a lot there as well, but I think certainly we would echo what Jill says in terms of kind of strengthening the level of identification of what needs to be done within the bill. But as you say, I mean, having worked in the sector for over 20 years, I'm always amazed by the passion and commitment of people and how much they want to tell us about what they want to do and how they want to see the changes happening. So I think undoubtedly, you know, we need to be thinking about how we engage these people and at what level. And as Jill says, both at stakeholder and local level, but I also think, you know, our third sector colleagues, our businesses, are extremely important because actually this is about cohesive policy. So we need to make sure that this just isn't done just to one set of people, that it needs to be coherent. And as I say, there's so many ways that we can do this. And, you know, Jill mentioned the Scottish Community Development Centre. They have standards for community engagement that can be built upon. There's obviously things like, obviously, again, Citizens Assembly, community-led research, so actually giving people the skills locally to actually speak to those that they work with, etc. You know, we've got real opportunities here with the kind of bill to outline what we would want people to, how that kind of engagement would be done. I think we do need some flexibility in it, though, because, you know, people will want to do this in different ways, you know, both locally and nationally. But I think we need to be clear that it needs to be done at every level. So stakeholders, local, you know, through businesses, for example, through trade bodies, you know, we've got lots of ways we can do that. And as Jill says, we've been doing it very well for years. I think we need to, you know, look at what we've got out there rather than trying reinventing the wheel as well. So there's lots of opportunities, I think, to engage with the sector, and we should certainly be taking those up to ensure that whatever we come out of this is actually informed by those who will, the policy will impact upon, but also who know more than us sitting in a room trying to develop something.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. Joe, did you want to comment? Have you got anything additional to add?
I don't have anything additional to add.
Grant, thanks very much. Alistair Allen.
Question perhaps for Claire Hislop and Joe Tees. There's something we've considered at previous meetings has been about whether or not a new body is needed to... I don't want to use the word enforce, but to ensure that the what's outlined in the bill and the envisaged plan works. Do we need a new body in this area, or can we not develop existing bodies that work around food in Scotland to fulfil that function?
Islip?
So I think in terms of the need for scrutiny around this bill is clear. And so we spoke earlier on about things like indicators, etc., that we need to outline and actually show how we're making improvement. The landscape around food policy is really cluttered in Scotland. And I think that we absolutely need some kind of oversight to ensure that actually we're making the progress that we need to see and that people are reporting in. Whether that's another food body, I think we would certainly see that at some, you know, there needs to be some kind of label where there's resources to enable that to happen. But whether it's an individual food body that's set up on its own or one that's attached to current food bodies with obviously already tasks around having kind of the scrutiny over, for example, the diet, etc. I think it's something we need to consider what the benefits of obviously the cost, for example, of setting up a new body versus actually putting this into something else. I think the other opportunity is obviously a group that potentially could come together to oversee this. But again, I think one of the fundamental points of this, with anything that needs to oversee the kind of scrutiny of this, there will need to be people who understand the complexity of the environment, there with the skills there to be able to do that, and it will need to be resourced in a sufficient way to enable this to actually happen. And that would be my view. Thank you.
Can I ask you that? Because before moving to Joe Tees, if you could elaborate a wee bit on what you mean there, Mrs. Lopp, about it being a cluttered environment. You say that the food, or the world of food, is quite a cluttered environment in some ways. I just wonder if you maybe just explain what you're thinking there.
Well, I mean, I think even looking at the evidence sessions, how many people you've had to give evidence, the number of people who have submitted responses, you know, from we're looking at, if you look at all the different aspects in which the bill includes, there is bodies, for example, Scotland Food and Drink, there's ourselves and Public Health Scotland, there's Food Standards Scotland, you know, there's Zero Waste Scotland. There is a huge amount of bodies already there that obviously have an agenda around this, and to bring in yet another body, we'd need to make sure that all these bodies would either feed into that, or is there somewhere currently that we could sit that work and have oversight of it, ensuring that obviously it's fair and equal and the scrutiny process is there. But to put in another body, well, as I say, I think that's something that would need to be kind of debated further. But I just, I mean, in terms of our view, I think there's lots of people out there doing really good jobs and could potentially take on this role, in addition to some people from other bodies coming together to support this.
And Joe Tees, I don't know if you have a view on that, or the point I made more generally about is a new body needed?
So our position, or our view as an association, would be no, we don't feel there is a new body. We feel, and I'm putting you on the spot here, Claire, but we feel that Public Health Scotland would be ideally placed to align this work to, because they already have their strategic objectives around food poverty, around health inequalities. They work alongside COSLA, priority 6 for the public health framework. So that was our position, that we felt, no, we didn't need a new body, but Public Health Scotland may be well positioned to align this work to.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, we're now moving on to a question from Arianna Burgess, question 7. Oh, maybe
thank
not.
You, Convener. Oh, I'm picking up on the themes of public and private sector roles, and I've got two questions 7 and 8. So we heard from previous panels about the role of public authorities in a good food nation. But I'd like to ask for your views. What responsibilities should public authorities take on in relation to procurement, health promotion, or education about food and the food system, for example? And to what extent do you believe the bill enables and supports them to fulfill this role? And I know we've started to touch in on those things, but I'd like to have a little bit more thinking. And I'd love to start with Jill Newry.
Thanks. In terms of public sector roles, I think that's wide-ranging, and that highlights the importance of having an integrated food policy that is vertically and horizontally aligned with other policies. So the public sector roles include, as you say, health promotion, they include food provision, they include planning. If we're thinking about 20-minute neighbourhoods, for example, how do people access affordable, nutritious food within that 20-minute neighbourhood? If we think about the areas around schools, how do we ensure that children are not bombarded with high-fat, salt, sugar, low-cost food around schools? There is also a role in terms of education, and I'm not just thinking about the curriculum here, but the curriculum is important, but the curriculum must align with the circumstances in which the school food or the school environment exists. So again, the area around school, the area around the school, and the food provided in the school, as well as education provided out with the school. So in community education, in further education, and in how we support and develop future business leaders and future innovators in the food sector. So I think there's a huge amount that the public sector can get involved in. They can also get involved in developing partnerships and leading on partnerships locally. So, for example, in Glasgow, we are in the process of setting up a sustainable procurement group that cuts across private and public sector procurers across the city and thinks about some of the challenges and opportunities for collaboration there. So I'm thinking about some of the universities are involved in that, as well as some of the local small businesses. and thinking through what are the challenges in for example, getting smaller bundles that smaller businesses can bid for in public procurement. So so there's a huge amount of potential roles for the public sector, which, as I say, I think just highlights the importance of having an integrated food policy that brings together quite a lot of these issues. The other thing I didn't mention is how we support the private sector and incentivise the private sector through some of the things that the public sector is doing. So, for example, in Glasgow and around COP, we were thinking about how do we highlight and promote those cities that are being forward thinking in terms of their sustainability around their food provision, and how do we support them to market what they're doing for the increasing number of tourists that we will be having as a city that are interested in spending their money in sustainable ways. So, as I say, there's a whole range of different public sector roles, which is why you need that collaborative approach. And that's why within the City Council, we take our papers to different committees and we have discussion with different councillors and different conveners around different aspects of our approach. And that's why we have a partnership that has representation from a wide range of bodies in the city, so that these different perspectives and different opportunities and different challenges can be raised.
Thanks for that, Jill. It's really great to hear about the, you know, full-on work that you're doing to ensure that there is this woven holistic approach by going to the different committees. I'm going to move on and bring in another question, and I think I'm going to start, Claire, by addressing it to you. But if anyone else wants to come in on either the one I just asked or this one, that would be great. So this is a two-part question. So the bill lists three types of relevant authorities who will be tasked with producing a Good Food Nation plan. That's local authorities, health boards, and any other specified public authorities. And I wonder if you would recommend any other specific bodies to include it in this list. And then the other part of the question is that last week, several witnesses suggested groups that these authorities should consult when drafting their plans. And the suggestions have included integrated joint boards who are responsible for ensuring that good food gets to those receiving social care. So I'd really like to hear your thoughts on this suggestion and whether you would recommend any other bodies or groups who should be consulted during the production of plans. So if I could start with Claire, and if anyone else wants to come in, you could put an R in the chat. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. So obviously in terms of kind of the public bodies, we absolutely want to see them leading by example. And obviously the bill highlights both the kind of, obviously the need to have plans for NHS boards and local authorities. I think, as Jill's just pointed out, though, the kind of collective nature of plans and actually being able to influence locally, it's really important that actually we kind of think much wider than that as well. And that ultimately, whether it be by area, you know, for example, like a bit like the work that Jill's doing, looking at how we can maximise how our public bodies provide food in a sustainable and obviously healthy, nutritious, etc. way. I think is really important. So I think we need to look at this right across the board. So in terms of things like obviously integrated joint boards, there's other areas, for example, like Scottish Prison Service, you know, basically anybody who is responsible for procuring of food, you know, serving food to others, I think we need to ensure that they're within this. I also don't think that we can forget about the fact that we need to think about our third sector partners and also the private sector within this as well. I think it would be naive to think that we can formulate plans without actually consulting and working with these people who actually are fundamentally going to influence the types of foods that we can buy, what foods are on offer, how foods are promoted, etc., within, you know, right across the board. So Jill mentioned earlier, for example, you know, all this good work we're doing within schools through education, through obviously school meals, etc. But yeah, actually when they leave the school gate, we need to work with, for example, convenience retail sector, you know, wider bodies to enable all this to happen. So I think, yeah, ultimately we do need to kind of consult and work with those who have plans kind of obviously through the public sector, but I think we need to widen that out as well. And as I say, I think there's some really good examples of this happening across Scotland. So we're working on some of the approaches who are looking at whole systems approaches to obesity. And there's some projects running just now which we are evaluating. And it's been really, really good to see the extent to which that local areas have been keen to take a kind of systems working approach, looking at a wide range of kind of local stakeholders that obviously drive the kind of elements of diet and obesity. And they've got to kind of identified a sort of shared understanding and shared actions so that they can tackle this. And I think, obviously, as I say, that's a bit like the work that Jill's doing as well. I think it's important that we look at this kind of more holistically when we're working with this. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. Is there anyone else who wants to come in on that? Any additional? Dr. Isabel Fletcher. Yeah.
I just wanted to make a brief comment. I mean, these are really rich and interesting examples of the work that's going on. And I think it highlights the need for some kind of body to coordinate these kind of collaboration doesn't happen without work being put in it and without some kind of coordination of it. And if we're talking about sharing best practice, collecting evidence, these are all arguments for some kind of statutory body to be filling that role. So Jill Muir is talking about the amazing work that's been done in Glasgow, and she says she needs, they would really want a kind of national steer and national strategies to advance that work. So that I mean, it's a fairly straightforward point. We need some kind of statutory body to be doing that. It won't happen. Lots is happening in lots of different places, but to make it more effective and to join these things up, somebody needs to be coordinating.
Okay, that's a really good point. I know a lot about community development and coordinating things on a community level, but do you think it needs to be, as some people are calling on, a Scottish Food Commission along the lines of a Scottish Land Commission, or as has been brought up, I think by Joe Tees, that it could be Public Health Scotland?
I think my personal preference would be for something like a Scottish Food Commission, because I think Public Health Scotland is doing great work in this area, but food covers so many different departments, policy areas, and historically we're not good at doing this kind of work across these areas. So, for example, I know from research I've been doing on another topic that health and environment within the Scottish Government don't talk to each other very well. And so if we have a body that's, if we use one of the existing bodies, then we may not be able to achieve this kind of joined up approach that we need.
Thank you very much for that perspective. Convener, thank you. I'm complete.
Thank you. A supplement from Rachel Hamilton.
I'll make it quick. Do you think that food education should be on the face of the Good Food Nation Bill? Can I start with Joe?
I have to apologise. I'm not 100% sure what you mean by on the face of the bill. But yes, we, as dietitians and as a profession, strongly advocate nutrition education is core. Particularly, Claire's mentioned the work within schools. We have dietitians within Education Scotland advising on school meals. Nutrition education goes across the lifespan, and as dietitians working in public health, we're well placed to educate from almost the cradle to the grave. So yeah, I would support that education is key within the bill.
Claire?
Thank you. Absolutely. I mean, education is so important. However, I think, you know, we absolutely need it embedded in the bill, and we already have things in place, but they could be strengthened. But I think fundamentally, it's only part of what we need to do, and it's not going to change the behaviour we see. I mean, my previous role was a school inspector, and you know, a lot of the children could tell me what they should be eating, but actually, could they access that locally at an affordable price? is a completely different matter. So I think whilst we can continue to educate, and I think it's really important that children not just learn about how to keep their bodies healthy, but also where their food comes and understand the complexities of what they're eating and how we, you know, we get to that stage of it sitting in front of their table. But I also think we need to make sure that the wider aspects of this policy coherence comes together so that children are able to actually implement what they learn in class. And also, I think, you know, it's not just about children. I think the kind of wider education as well, we need to make sure where possible, we're making sure that, you know, people are as informed as possible about the types of foods that we're eating. And that will help kind of change the way that we eat and how we view about food as well. So I think education is so important. It's just part of the picture though. Thank you.
Do I have time to ask, who have I missed? Claire? Sorry, Jill? Jill?
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think that education is important. Again, it depends what you mean by education, but it's important and it's necessary, but it's not sufficient to make the changes that we want to see happen. If you think about major public health achievements that we have achieved in Scotland, education was not sufficient. We needed substantial changes in the circumstances in which people lived, or legislation that supported them. So yes, education is important, and I would go beyond nutrition education. Young people, children in schools, the curriculum needs to reflect the whole food system in terms of how, in terms of what they learn about. They, particularly with the climate emergency, they need to understand the role that food plays in that. They need to understand, to be food literate, if you like, to understand what the impact of their food choices are, in terms of workers' rights, and in terms of the impact on different countries, and a whole range of different things. So food, the ethics of food, sustainability, and I know that there's lots of work going on in Learning for Sustainability Scotland that is putting using food in a sustainability context in schools-based education, which is really helpful to learn from. And I know Strathclyde Uni's been doing some really good work around that as well. So I think food, building on the good work that's happened and embedding food and a holistic approach to food in the curriculum is really important. I know loads of schools have done brilliant stuff, particularly at primary level. I think it becomes much more of a challenge in secondary level, but I think there are real opportunities to build debates around food, for example, into modern studies. You know, there are real issues going on in the food system that are really important for young people to grapple with and understand. And I think going beyond that, the opportunity to build young people's skills to be innovative leaders in a new food system is really important. We are struggling to employ young people in our agriculture sector. We're struggling to employ people in our sustainable food sector who understand and are able to grapple with some of these new technologies that we need to build. So I think there's opportunities in working with our further education colleagues and with our higher education colleagues and apprenticeships, training opportunities to build that workforce. We in Glasgow are building in sustainability into the chef courses and the catering courses at college, so that our new chefs can understand not just about the nutritional principles that they should be thinking about, but also about how to build sustainability into the food provision that they are planning. Because ultimately, what we found, and this is going on a bit of a tangent, what we found when we speak to our procurement colleagues is actually they're not the ones with the power. The ones with the power are deciding on the menus. And they then set out the procurement requirements in line with that. So actually, we need to be thinking about how do we build healthy, sustainable food into our meal plans, into our menu planning, into how do we build seasonality into that? And then how do we support a local food system to develop that meets those needs so that that money that is invested in procurement stays within that local economy? So there is education required around that as well. We also need to think about how you educate the public around what a healthy, sustainable diet looks like. And also we need to educate our food retailers and our food producers around how to meet that need. So I think education goes really wide. It's absolutely essential, but it's not sufficient. It's necessary, but not sufficient. We need to think about the circumstances and the context and the structures that are in place that support the new knowledge that people have.
Thank you.
Thank you. I've got some questions specifically looking at the views from Public Health Scotland, that there's a requirement in health boards to consult on and publish a Good Food Nation plan under Section 7 of the Bill. But there's also a requirement for health boards to have regard in these plans when exercising specific functions, but we don't know what those functions are yet. They're not laid out in the face of the bill. So can I have your views on that? But also the resource implications, looking at the cost of consulting and publishing a Good Food Nation plan, the Scottish Government suggests that any costs arising are negligible. Do you agree with that? That the costs involved in putting it all together would be negligible? And that obviously goes to Claire.
Okay, so I think it's quite difficult to answer this question because they haven't actually outlined kind of the function of the bill. It's not quite clear to me what we would be required to do. And I think, you know, obviously, I think one of the things that's been happening in this evidence is about how we outline that more succinctly so that people know what's expected of them. In terms of the budgetary things, I couldn't comment on costs. I mean, certainly in terms of being able to deliver a Good Food Nation plan is going to take a resource. It's going to take people to obviously think about, you know, how you facilitate that across your board. I also think we then need to obviously link up with obviously others in local authorities, businesses, procurement, etc. So that's all going to take time. And obviously the level at which we've all agreed today there needs to be participation with others obviously as well is going to come at a cost. So I think there will be a significant resource, whether that's financial linked to people or, you know, budgetary, I think will need to be considered. But I think until it's clearer outline what's within the bill, I think it'd be hard for anybody to kind of reflect on what that would cost. Sorry, I can't be more help.
Yeah, I suppose because you've given us your opinion of what the Good Food Nation bill should deliver and aspire to and the ambitions. So you should, or Public Health Scotland should have an idea of what a plan might look like. And we've taken evidence for that over the last few weeks and we've had the consultation responses. So there should be a good indication of what's going to be in that plan and therefore an indication to health boards of what the cost or the resource implication of pulling those together is. That's really, really important. Do you think that the functions or specified functions need to be laid out on the face of the bill so that we're absolutely certain what the plans from each individual health board are going to deliver, and it's not then down to cost and resource implications and based on the position that individual boards are?
I mean, I think, I would agree that we have to lay out what we want to happen. And I think, obviously, the local boards will be looking to the national plan as well. So the national plan has to have substance in our ability so that we can align to this. But, I mean, I think we've spoke very much about the need for flexibility locally for people to adapt their plans as well. But, I mean, fundamentally, I think we need to be clearer about what the purpose of this bill is so that people know what we should be striving to achieve. And we spoke earlier about ambitions, targets for implementation and things. So that needs to be, I think, considered before we can realistically think how much that would cost. But, I mean, I think even just putting plans together will take resource. Actually, in terms of implementing them, you know, I wouldn't have any idea how that would cost as well. And I think, obviously, in terms of Public Health Scotland, we're obviously a special board and not a local board as well. So we need to think about being more inclusive as well about how other people might be required to write some kind of plan or support others to write their plan or at least be involved in, for example, the national plan.
Thank you. And I'll move on to Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Convener. This has been a fascinating session, folks, so thank you very much for your input. I have really enjoyed it and taken a lot out of it. But I'd really like to explore the roles and responsibilities of the private sector and the Good Food Nation with regards to delivering public health outcomes and how the bills and plans can support and enable the private sector to play a positive role. And when we talk about the private sector, I would include the food producers in that, because one of the things I have a difficulty with in all the sessions that we've had is there seems to be a dichotomy here between we want to have environmental protections, we want to protect biodiversity, we want farmers to be able to continue to produce food locally with short supply chains, but we also have massive food inequalities in this country. And how do we get the private sector to recognise that dichotomy and work together so that they can be part of the Good Food Nation Bill? Can I start off with Isabel? I'll start off with you to begin with, if that's okay. Sorry for that.
Thank you.
So, do you mean that?
start with a hard question. Some of it is about looking at what the government does and developing more coherence so that we incentivize the private sector. So the thing I've heard, I've been doing, as I said, I was doing some work in rural areas, and it was upland rural areas, and a lot of that was talking about the environmental impact of livestock farming, and they talk about public money for public goods. So we are supporting farmers and other food producers to produce food in the most environmentally benign manner possible, rather than having perverse incentives to produce food in ways that are environmentally damaging. And I know this is slightly off public health. I think we also need to think about SMEs, small and medium enterprises. A lot of people want to set up food businesses. There are a lot of people who want to grow food and sell food, cook, set up small catering businesses. It's a difficult thing to do, and I think the government could support people more partly by providing better infrastructure. So I did research on Sky, bad roads, bad broadband, a lack of abattoirs, if you're talking about meat, make it very difficult to set up small food businesses on that island. And so there's things there are opportunities there which I think are rare in public policy for win-win situations. Tim Lang did a report, and I'll wind up after this one. Tim Lang did a report about 5 years ago about British horticulture. I know in the last session this issue came up. There's a gap between what we produce and what we eat, and we could close that gap by supporting small-scale producers to grow more fruit and vegetables. We can't grow peppers and tomatoes in the UK, but we can grow potatoes, turnips, onions, cabbages. We could grow a lot more of what we eat. And that is one way in which the private sector can contribute to the goals of a good food nation.
Thank you very much. Can I go to Joe Tease on this one? Because we heard earlier on from some of the other panellists about the National Planning Framework. We can give all the education we like, but ultimately we need the availability of the kind of foods that you, as a dietitian, would want to see our young people eating. So how can the private sector play their role?
Great question, and I think that links one of our reflections was there perhaps needs more engagement with the private partners around the bill. Food sustainability as well is a key factor there. There are some reflections. I know the aim of the bill is to get rid of the need for food banks, but we see as dietitians the food that is provided within food banks is not always nutritionally balanced or nutritionally appropriate. So I guess there's work there as well around, it goes back to food poverty and food sustainability. So it's making sure people are educated on what is a healthy, balanced diet as well. More than happy to provide more evidence around this question if that would be helpful as well.
Yeah, thank you very much. Claire, what's your thoughts on this?
So I think the private sector, I think I said before, have a key role in helping us obviously have a good food nation. I think there's a couple of things here. You know, we want these businesses to be flourishing as well and boosting our economy, and therefore they can afford to pay our workforce sufficiently, which again improves public health. We've got all that through there as well. I think we have an opportunity here to try and change and shift. If we coordinate policy better, there will be hopefully a better requirement, and people will want healthier, nutritionally balanced, sustainable food. And therefore, we kind of obviously can support businesses to do that locally. I think there's a real opportunity to help businesses support their ambitions to flourish as well. And I think I know businesses are quite reticent at the moment, potentially because of the impacts a lot of obviously our sectors had around the pandemic. But I think if we can, through the bill, look at ways that we can support obviously how businesses flourish, because obviously all the things that has it boosts our economy, our workforce, etc. In addition to looking at the kind of wider aspects around improving the types of foods that we have on offer within our retailers, things that we produce locally, etc. as well. So I think there's a real opportunity to try and harness this in a real positive way in working together with our private sector to enable this to actually happen. Thank you.
Specifically for yourself, you probably remember when Hungry for Success was implemented that East Ayrshire went for it absolutely hammer and tongs and created a gold standard. Can the private sector be encouraged to do that in your area? To get involved with it, Jill? Yes?
So one of the differences between us and Ayrshire is not a huge amount of food growing goes on within the boundaries of Glasgow. And so that's one of the things we've been looking at, is how do we use some of the learning in Ayrshire, and that's one of the reasons why we're working with the City Region, or we've been trying to work with the City Region to think through where are the opportunities there. We've been working with the inclusive growth work going on with the City Region to think through how do we maybe develop a project looking at maybe one foodstuff or one small bit of the public sector procurement within that city region, and how can we maybe think about how to build shorter supply chains and more local produce into that. So that's something that's ongoing. These discussions are ongoing. We're not there yet, but it is a challenge. I think public procurement has an important role to play, and thinking about how can we align the products that our public sector colleagues are looking for with what is produced locally, and then where there are gaps there, how can we stimulate and support the local economy to develop production of those foodstuffs is one area, and that would I think that would then stimulate an incentive for more producers to start producing that. So one example I have of one business I was speaking to, a private business actually, had a need for a grated cheese for their sandwiches, which they then sold to supermarkets. But they got their grated cheese from Dumfries. No, they got their cheese from Dumfries, but they couldn't find anywhere that would grate it. So the cheese went to Wales to be grated and came back. Now there are, there are examples of I mean, I think these examples are all over the place, where we could just maybe think a little bit more in detail about some of these supply processes, and where can we support Scottish businesses to intervene in there, or to develop processes or facilities to do the bit, so that we can keep it in Scotland, reduce those miles, keep the business in Scotland. So we are in the process of thinking about that in Glasgow. The other thing we're thinking about is how we can use our vacant and derelict land, and how we can use more innovative processes in Glasgow, vertical farming and such like, to build more food production into the city boundary. Again, those discussions are in relatively early stages and involve thinking through where we can get funding. And again, having a collaborative approach in the city does help us in bidding for funding to start trying out some pilot processes of new innovative approaches to food production. But I think there is something about thinking about seasonality, what we can produce, adapting our menu plans so that we are looking for food that is more easily produced. There's something about supporting small businesses, local businesses, to develop the production processes for the food that we need, that is in demand by the public sector. And there's also something about supporting local more generally, so encouraging people in general, retailers, the public to think about buying local. And I think there are some shops and some outlets and some retail establishments, some restaurants that do that really well. And there are others that maybe don't do. And I think that more could be done around encouraging and highlighting the benefit to the local economy of using more local produce.
Thank you very much, Ed. That brings us to the end of the session. So Isabel, Claire, Jill and Joe, thank you very much for your time this morning. We very much appreciate it. We now move on to our third item of business today, which is consideration of two notifications from Scottish Ministers for Consent to the Phytosanitary Conditions Amendment Regulations 2022 and the Milk and Milk Products Pupils in Education Establishments Aid Applications, England and Scotland Regulations 2022, and I refer members to paper 3 on page 21. Under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, these consent notifications have been categorised as Type 1, meaning that Scottish Parliament's agreement is sought before the Scottish Government gives consent to the UK Government making secondary legislation in devolved competence. Considering the two notifications separately, in relation to the Phytosanitary Conditions SI notification, do any members have any comments on the consent notification? Please either raise your hand or type R in the chat box if you're participating remotely. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UK SI? Please raise your hand or type N in the chat box. If we do not agree otherwise, I'll presume members are content. We are content. In relation to the milk and milk products SI notification, does any member have any comment on this consent notification? No. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UK SI? Please raise your hand or type in the chat box if we do not agree. Otherwise, I will presume members are content. Members are content. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off a letter to the Scottish Government informing it of our decision today? Content. Thank you. We now move on to agenda item 4, which is consideration of a negative instrument, the Private Storage Aid Scheme Pigmeat Scotland Amendment Regulation 2021/2021-492. And I refer members to paper 4 on page 26. No motion to annul these instruments have been lodged. Members will note that the instruments breached the rules which require SSIs to be laid at least 28 days before they come into effect. The Scottish Government's letter to the presiding officer states that this is due to the need to act urgently to avoid an economic loss to farmers by not accepting additional cuts of pig meat into the scheme. I can also just note to the committee that we wrote to the Scottish Government with questions when we originally considered the pig meat scheme SSI. We've yet to receive a response. Do any members have any comments on this instrument? Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask why loins weren't included in the first place to the pig meat storage aid scheme?
We can certainly write to the Scottish Government for clarification on that.
Thanks.
Certainly. Are members content to note the instrument? Content? Thank you. So that concludes our business in public. We'll now move into private session to continue the agenda. We'll now meet in private session. Thank you.